All right, let's start. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Bridge Course session on Introduction to Calculus. Okay, this is the session two. I think in the session one, if you would recall, I had introduced the concepts of limits to you, right? So don't worry, even if you're not present in the last class, I'm going to just quickly recap what we did the last class before starting on today's session. All right, so hope I'm audible to everyone. I'm loud and clear. My screen is visible, right? With Introduction to Calculus session two written on it. And also you can see me on the video over here. Okay. So let us start with a quick recap. So last class, I had just spoken about what's a limit actually. Okay. We didn't do much questions on it. Neither did we learn a lot of tools and methodologies required to evaluate limits. So we just talked about what is limit, the informal definition of limits. So that's what I'm going to repeat, initially in the class today. So the first thing that we did was knowing what is limit. When I say limit of a function as x tends to a, okay, what does it mean? It means as x approaches a, right? What is the value to which f of x is approaching to? Or what is the value that f of x is achieving? Okay. That value is called the limit. So this value is what we call as the limit. Okay. So this is what we call as the limit x tends to a of the function. Correct. Second important thing that we discussed in the class was limit can only be found out. That means limit of a function as x tends to a only exists if you can evaluate the left hand limit and you can evaluate the right hand limit as x tends to a. That is what we write it as, limit f of x extending to a minus. Okay, remember what was this called? This was called the left hand limit. Yes or no? Okay, in short we'll call it as LHL. Okay, and this is what we call as the right hand limit. The right hand limit, okay, RHL. Okay, only when both of them are equal, that value that they're equal to is what we call as the limit. Okay, and remember, limit is always a finite quantity. Limit is always a finite quantity. You cannot state any answer of a limit to be infinity or minus infinity. Okay, however, you can always state infinity and minus infinity as the value of just the left hand limit or just the right hand limit. Okay, so it may happen that, see, there may be questions that you may have done in your assignments. What is the limit of 1 by x as x tends to 0 plus? What is the answer? Plus infinity, right? So this tends to plus infinity. Okay, what is the value of 1 by x as x tends to 0 minus? Okay, that's minus infinity. Okay, that is fine. But we cannot state that the answer to any kind of a limit question is infinity or minus infinity. Now, I have got various questions from people in the doubt after the last class. Sir, if the left hand limit and the right hand limit both are infinity, aren't they equal? And hence my answer is infinity. Please let me tell you, this logic is not correct. Okay. When two quantities both go towards infinity, that doesn't mean they're going towards the very same large number. Right? Two infinities need not be the same. Please understand this. Okay. I'll give you a simple example. Right now here you see that this quantity is infinity. Correct? If I ask you what is the limit of 1 by x square as x tends to 0 or 0 plus, 0 minus, whatever, both the answers will be the same. Even this will tend to infinity. Correct? Even this will tend to infinity. But are these two infinity the same? No. Right? They're different infinities. Correct? So never treat two infinities to be the same figures. They are just a representative for a very, very large number which we are unable to express. It doesn't mean two infinities are same. Okay. You'll come across instances where one infinity is comparable to another infinity. It may be infinite times bigger than the other infinity. It may be infinite times lesser than the other infinity. Okay. So infinity minus infinity, I'll come to this figure today in the discussion, one of our discussions. This can take any answer right from minus infinity to plus infinity. Okay, it can take any answer in this range, right? Okay, so never ever treat two infinities to be the same. They are very large number. Just understand it in this way. They are just two very, very large numbers which we cannot represent, right, by use of numbers. Okay, so quick recap that infinity or minus infinity cannot be stated as an answer to a limit. It has always to be a finite value. However, you may write left hand or right hand limit to be plus minus infinity as the case may be. Okay, that is acceptable. Now the third thing is, in fact, this is a continuation of the same property. You can say this 2a and 2b. If your left hand limit and the right hand limit are not the same, what does it mean? Right? What does it mean? It means that the limit of the function as x tends to a does not exist. Please note that it does not exist. Okay, this is primarily what we had done the last class. And not to forget the very important concept that there is actually a difference between the value of the function at a and the limit of the function as x tends to a. They are quite different things. Okay, they are quite different things. Now in some occasions they are equal, but in most of the occasions they will not be equal. Now in what occasions they are equal, we'll discuss it in today's class. Don't worry about it. But this is what we had done the last class. Okay. So when we are evaluating the limit, we just see what is the function tending to just before a? What is the function tending to just after a? That is what we call as left hand limit and right hand limit. And if these two values are very close to each other or almost going towards the same figure, then only we say that the limit exists, and the quantity to both, the quantity to which both these left hand limit and the right hand limit are going towards, that is what we call as the limit of the function, right? So this is what we had discussed the last class. Now let us resume with today's, you know, session. Meanwhile, any question here? Any question on these two important concepts which we took up the last class? Okay. So let me wish good afternoon to everybody who has joined in. Okay, good afternoon to everyone. no problem, Shitij. We did not do anything important up till now. Now we are going to start with the important part. Okay, now how do we evaluate limit? How do we evaluate limits? We can write it as the topic name, methods to evaluate limit. Evaluate limit. Okay. Now, last class, remember when we were evaluating the limits for some functions, we started putting some values slightly left to a and slightly right to a. Now that approach is not practical. That approach is not feasible. If you start following that approach to solve questions, let me tell you, there may be some questions which will, you know, take hours to do it. Okay. So there are some quick handy methods by which we can, you know, find our limits very quickly. You can say within 2 to 3 minutes, you can evaluate any limit on this earth. Okay. So we are going to discuss those methods. Okay. Now the functions that we get primarily, okay, they fall under two categories. They fall under two categories. One, what we call as continuous functions. Okay, we can say continuous at a, where a is this point where you are evaluating the limit, and the other falls into the categories of what we call as the indeterminate form. Okay, this form is one of the most debated concepts in the field of mathematics. So we'll discuss about it in today's session. Okay, so How many types of functions are there when you are evaluating the limits? So while evaluating the limit, you will come across, my dear students, two types of functions. What are they? They may be continuous function at A. Now, what is the meaning of continuous at A? What do you understand when you hear this word continuous at A? Anybody? Anybody can unmute yourself and talk. Yeah. So Shithi says they have a real value at x equal to a. Y exists at a. All of you are saying the same thing. Very good. It just means that the function is defined at that point. The function is defined at that point and it matches with the value of the function left and right to it. That means there is no break in the function. Okay. There is no break in the function. There is no hole in the function. Okay, at x equal to a. Okay, so one type of question that you get will be evaluating the limit of such functions which do not show any kind of a breakage, which do not show any kind of a hole at x equal to a. Okay, now these are those functions which are called continuous functions, but they will be rarely asked in your school exam or competitive exam. Why? Because for such functions you can evaluate the limit very quickly by just substituting this a in place of x. Okay, a typical example is what we had done the last class. Let's say I'm evaluating the limit of x plus 4 as x tends to 1. Okay, if you draw the graph of this function, let me just quickly draw the graph of x plus 4, a miniature graph I will draw, not a big one. Okay, now this function x plus 4, okay, it absolutely doesn't have any problem at x equal to 1. Okay, so if you just look into this area at x equal to 1, it doesn't have any kind of a problem, no hole, no break. Okay, so what this method says that if you are given with such a function which you know that it is continuous at that point where you are evaluating the limit, it is as good as putting the value of 1 in place of x and evaluating your answer. So 5 is your limit. You don't have to do 0.99, 0.999, 0.99999 like that, or 1.1, 1.01, 1.001. Don't do all that. Just a waste of time. Because it is only, you know, meant for you to understand the concept. So the practical aspect of it is, for such functions, we just get the answer by putting the value of a in place of x. Simple as that. Right? Right? Now, a normal question that would arise in your mind when you hear this concept is, number one, isn't sir contradicting what he said? Right? Does that question arise in your mind? Arey, sir told me the other day, you know, there's a difference between the value of the function at a and the limit of the function as x tends to a. Now he's saying both of them are same thing. Okay, now I'm not saying both are the same thing, but this is just a faster means to evaluate it. Else you are most welcome to waste your time doing that informal approach or the primitive approach of your understanding of limits. Okay, see, it's just that if man can fly, okay, it doesn't make him a bird. He can fly by the use of some helicopter, aircraft. Okay, so just because you are evaluating the limit by putting the value of x as a into the function, that doesn't mean the value of the function is the limit concept. No, they're still different. It's just that doing it gives you the answer in a much, much faster way. Getting my point? Okay. I still hold by my, you know, previous argument that yes, both the things are different, because when you are approaching x equal to a, right, whatever is happening at a is none of my business. It may be undefined at that point, right? It may not be defined at that point, but still I can evaluate the limit. Now in this particular case, when I say particular case, means only when your functions show this nature of continuity at x equal to a, you can save your time, effort, energy by just evaluating f of a and saying that is your limit. Okay. Now the next type of question, functions that you get, mind you, such kind of questions will be hardly 0.000001%. In fact, tending to zero. No questions will be asked in these kind because it is so easy. You can just put the value of x and get your answer, right? So this type of questions will be almost negligible. Zero questions almost you can say will be asked on this type. Okay. Most of the question, which is 99.99%, would be the ones which fall under this category, indeterminate form. Indeterminate form. Okay. Now just understand this in a very simple and layman terms. Okay. Limit is a vaccination or a tool or a medicine, you can say, to treat two types of functions. One, continuous type function, and other is indeterminate type functions. What is indeterminate? I'll explain you in some time. Think like as if, you know, limit is like a doctor, okay? And these two forms are like the patients which visit that doctor, right? Now, when do you visit a doctor? When either you feel you are sick, right? When you're actually really sick, let's say you have a fever, vomiting, stomach ache, you'll go and visit a doctor, correct? Or you will visit a doctor just for a general checkup, right? Just to see whether nothing is wrong with you. Okay, let's say you woke up one fine morning and you had some dizziness and you went to see a doctor just to see whether your blood sugar level is, you know, normal or not. Okay, in actual sense, you may not have any issues. The dizziness may be because, you know, probably you studied hard last night, right? And you did not sleep well. Okay. The second case is when you actually have a problem. So these are the cases where you are actually having a problem in the function. Continuous was a case where you were okay, but you just wanted to confirm whether I'm okay or not. Okay. So 99% of the patients which will visit a doctor is when they actually have a problem. Else nobody wants to see a doctor unless they are your relatives. Okay. So now understand this fact, like most of the questions that will be given to you, I can say near to 100% will be the ones suffering from indeterminate forms. Now, what is this indeterminate forms? There are 7 indeterminate forms that, you know, you'll come across. Okay. You can think as if there are 7 types of diseases that you may, you know, go to a doctor for cure. Okay. The first type of disease is what we call as tending to zero by tending to zero. This is an indeterminate form. I think I had introduced this form to you in the first class. Okay. For brevity, we'll call it as zero by zero form. But remember, zero by zero should not be read as exact zero by exact zero. Exact zero by exact zero is undefined in maths. There's no way we can cure that disease. Correct. So what are we curing? We are curing an indeterminate form where we have two such expressions in the numerator and denominator, whereas x tends to a, both of these numerator and denominator will start tending towards zero. Okay. And side by side, I'll give you an example also for it. Okay. Let's say you have an expression of this nature. I think this is the example which we had done the last class, right? So this is a typical classical example for this type of indeterminacy. Okay. So this function is suffering from this disease. You can think like that. Okay. And limit is basically a doctor which is there to cure its disease. Okay. So limit is like finding answers to such indeterminate forms. Correct. So this is one of the types. There can be several others. In, you know, sometime we'll study limit sine x by x extending to zero. Okay, that is also suffering from the same form, same problem. Okay, limit e to the power x minus 1 by x. Okay, that is also suffering from the same form. Okay, so all these, you know, type of functions, you'll realize that as x tends to a, whatever is there a, it may be 1, it may be 0, you can see that both the numerator and denominator are tending to 0. But nevertheless, right? They're not exactly zero. They're not exactly zero. For exactly zero, we cannot evaluate it. We just have to surrender and say, boss, nobody can save you. You are undefined. Okay. Now you must be wondering what are the other six indeterminate forms. Let's quickly look into it without much waste of time. The other indeterminate forms are infinity by infinity. Now why we call it as an indeterminate? Okay. Why the name has come indeterminate? Of course they have a problem that we understand, but why do we call a disease, you know, as that name? Okay. We call this as indeterminate because you cannot determine it by just looking at the expression, right? They can give you the same indeterminate form, that is, let's say tending to zero by tending to zero, that depending upon the functions involved, it can give you several answers, right? For example, in this case, we learned that the answer was 2, correct? But in this case, again, it is a zero by tending to zero by tending to zero form, but now this case, the answer is going to be 1. Don't worry about how 1 and how 2. We'll take up all these concepts a little later on. So you cannot determine the value of such functions just by looking at them until unless you apply this concept of limits on it. So indeterminate means cannot be determined, even though the answer is there, we cannot determine it without application of limits concept. Okay, so infinity by infinity, nobody can say it's going to be 1. Can we say that infinity by infinity is 1? Remember, two infinities need not be the same, right? So my answer could be anything. Now this infinity may be 5 times this infinity, who knows, right? This infinity may be, let's say, minus 100 times this infinity, who knows, correct? Right? So infinity by infinity, you can also include plus infinity by minus infinity or minus infinity by minus infinity. Both, all of them will be dealt under the same, you can say, under the same umbrella. Okay. So two infinities need not be the same. What are the examples of this? Let me give you a typical example. The typical example is the one which we had, used in case of finding horizontal asymptotes, let's say 2x minus 5 by 3x plus 2, x tending to infinity. Okay, as you can see, when x goes to infinity, the numerator goes to infinity, denominator goes to infinity. But nevertheless, those two infinities are not the same, right? In reality, the answer to this is basically what? Anybody knows? 2 by 3. Yes, 2 by 3. Okay, so when we talk about such cases, we are dealing with which form of indeterminacy? Infinity by infinity, right? Many a times, these indeterminate forms are interconvertible. In fact, not many a times, I can say in most of the cases, you can convert, one to each other. For example, the same thing, I could have written it 1 by 3x plus 2 divided by 1 by 2x minus 5. Okay, limit extending to infinity. Then in this case, it would have become a 0 by 0 form. So I've converted one indeterminate form to the other. Okay. So please note, you can convert one indeterminate form to other also. Okay. The applications of conversion we'll see towards the end of this course, while we are talking about limits and derivatives chapter in the regular session. Okay. There's something called L'Hopital's rule and all. We'll talk about it. Okay. Next is infinity minus infinity. Now again, the answer here is indeterminate, right? People ask me, sir, why it is indeterminate? Isn't it zero? Infinity minus infinity. Again, the same answer, same argument from my side. Two infinities are not the same. Okay. You can get any answer ranging from minus infinity to infinity for this. So it all depends upon what are the questions, what are the functions involved. Okay, a typical example of such indeterminacy would be this example, limit extending to infinity. Let's say I take something like x square plus x plus 1 minus under root of x square plus 1. Okay, so this is something which is tending to infinity. This is also tending to infinity, but they are not the same infinities. So you can have a finite answer for this, right? That depends upon how you solve it. Next type of indeterminacy, or next type of indeterminate form, is tending to 1 to the power of infinity. This is one of the most important types of indeterminate forms you'll come across. It's a very, very important form. Okay. Most of your competitive exams question will be, you know, revolving around this type of indeterminacy. If you are eager to learn about these types, there is a video of mine on the Centum Academy channel. You just type limits and you'll see a video. It's a 4-hour session, I think. Okay. So I've talked about most of these indeterminate forms. Except the first one. First one I have not discussed. 2, 3, 4, whatever I'm going to write next till 7. Those forms have been discussed there. So if you want to be ahead of, you know, time, you can just go through those videos. Now again, tending to 1 to the power infinity. It's not 1 to the power infinity. 1 to the power infinity will always be 1. There's no doubt about it. Right? But if there is a quantity which is tending to 1. See, let's say if I have 1.00004, okay, raised to the power of, let's say, 1 lakh. Okay, let's say 1 lakh. Yeah, if you have a calculator in front of you, can somebody tell me what is the answer for this? Anybody? Actually, I don't have a calculator with me and I don't know. Oh, digits exceeded. Okay. Anyways, never mind. So when I say such a thing, please note, right? This is a quantity which is coming close to zero, but still we can't call it as tending to one. Okay. Tending to one is something of this nature. The most classical example is the one which we use to evaluate E. Do you remember we had done an expression of this type, right? This is a typical example where you can see that this quantity, when x tends to infinity, will go towards zero. That means overall this quantity will go towards one, correct? That's why tending to one, correct? Tending to one. And as x goes to infinity, the exponent goes to infinity, so power infinity, right? So you can see that in such cases, the answer that you got was E. So the types of indeterminacy which involve, you know, such a type where there is a 1 in the base, or there is a tending to 1 in the base, and there is a power which is very large, those are categorized under 1 to the power infinity indeterminate form, because this answer can range anywhere from 0 up till infinity. Of course, it cannot become negative answer. Okay. It can go anywhere from 0 up to infinity. Okay. There will be several other examples once you see the video. Oh yeah. Arya says it's going to be 54-ish. Okay. So yes. So something like this can give you any answer that depends upon how close you are to 1 and how big is this power of infinity. Okay. As I told you, this is very important. Fifth one, this is an example for that. Okay, this is an example for this one. Let me write down the fifth one. Fifth one is tending to 0 into infinity. Tending to 0 into infinity. Now, many people say, what? Is this an indeterminate form? Won't it ever always give you 0? Right? Why it is indeterminate? I can determine it. It's 0. The answer is no. No, it is not 0. Basically, when a quantity is very small, okay, when it is present in finite number, its significance may not be that much. It may still be 0. For example, 5 drops of water or 100 drops of water, or let's say even 1,000 drops of water is not a very, very, you know, big amount. Okay. But when you have billions and trillions drop of water, it may make up a ocean. It may result into a sea. It may result into a river. It may result into a lake. It may result into a pond. It may result into, let's say, a tank of water, right? Or a bucket of water, or a cup of water, or a, you know, cap of your, you know, water bottle of water, right? So it depends upon how small is the quantity, how small is this quantity, how infinitesimal is this quantity, and how big is the number of those quantities. right? So never underestimate, you know, the power of these tending to zero quantity when they are present in infinite number of quantity. Okay, right? So never underestimate the power of, you know, common man, right? So when they are very much in number, you cannot, they become a mob, right? You cannot handle them. Okay. A classical example is Germany going into World War II. Sir, isn't it that one? Which is one? No, that's the point. It can give any answer. It can give any answer, Kshitij. Right? Please do not take some... Many people think infinity is 1 by 0 and all. Right? No. It's just a very large quantity. It's a very large quantity. It's nothing divided by 0. It's something which is divided by a quantity which is tending to 0. No. All that thing is... Again, you're doing the same mistake. You're cancelling infinity with infinity. Are the two infinities the same? Okay. Please try to get this point. The moment we see infinity, we think all infinity in the world are the same numbers. No, they are not the same numbers. Every infinity has a different story. Okay. So, two infinities, they can be different also. As I gave you the example, no? 1 by x square and 1 by x tending to 0 plus. Both are infinities, but both are not the same infinities. Is that fine? Okay. Next is tending to 0 to power tending to 0. Now, many people first ask me, sir, what is exactly 0 to the power exactly 0? That is undefined. That is undefined. Okay. But tending to 0 to the power tending to 0, it can have a value that can be a finite value, right? So unless I know what are those two quantities, and unless I apply what are my limits of my concept of limits on them, we cannot evaluate those values. So looking at them, it's very difficult to determine their value. That's why they get the name indeterminate form. But of course, when you go for a further diagnosis, right, when you do a lot of tests and checkups on it, again, I'm using the medical field terminologies, or you apply the concept of limits on it, you can find the values for that. Okay. To give you a typical example of this is limit x tending to 0. Let's say sine x to the power of tan x. So this is an example of that. Okay. Acha, one example that I forgot to give the fifth one. A typical example could be limit x tending to 0. X into ln x. Okay. So when you're evaluating the answers for such questions, we will have to use the concept of limits. Okay. And finally, the seventh one. Sorry, I don't have much space over here. Seventh one, let me write it over here. It's infinity to the power of tending to 0. Infinity to the power of tending to 0. Okay. Now, even this is an indeterminate form. Why it is indeterminate form? See, tending to 0 means what? Tending to 0 means some fixed quantity. Yeah, or I'll just show it to you. Yeah, 6-1 is tending to 0 to the power tending to 0. Okay. Is that fine? Now, seventh quantity, which is again an indeterminate form, infinity to the power 0. Okay, this is also an indeterminate form. The reason being, when you say tending to 0, okay, let's say tending to 0, I take a quantity 1 by, you know, 1 followed by, let's say, you know, 1 million zeros. Okay, this is a quantity tending to 0. What does it mean? It means you're taking this root of infinity. Now, infinity itself is a very huge number. If you're dividing into equal parts of the, you know, equal so many parts, you can say 1 followed by million zeros, whatever number is that. When you're taking that at root of infinity, it can still give you a finite answer. The number can be so big that you can still see a finite answer. For example, I can see a 20 coming out from that. Isn't it? So, unless until The size of this and the size of this is known to me in terms of function. I will not be able to tell the answer to you. And that's why again we call such forms as indeterminate forms. A typical example of this could be, limit extending to pi by 2. Let's say tan x to the power of cos x. Okay, tan x to the power of, you know, cos x. Or you can say tan x to the power of cot x. No, cot x will go to infinity, right? So we can take something which tends to 0. Okay, cos x is fine. Okay. Now, out of these, what you didn't understand, Auro? The last one, seventh one? Okay, see, what I'm trying to say, I'm trying to justify why we call these as indeterminate. Why we cannot, you know, write down the answer for this straight away. See, there are some terms where we can write down the answer straight away. For example, infinity plus infinity. Will you call this as indeterminate form? No, because the answer is infinity. Okay, even though that exact number is very difficult to find out, but we don't call such forms as indeterminate. Because you don't have to put any kind of analysis, any kind of limits on it to get its value. Okay. Similarly, we cannot call infinity to the power infinity as indeterminate form because we know the answer is going to be infinity. Correct. We cannot call 0 to the power infinity also as indeterminate form, or you can say tending to the power 0 to the power infinity as indeterminate form because the answer to that will be 0. Correct. So why do I call certain forms indeterminate and why we don't call certain forms indeterminate is because the answer to that process could be any number depending upon that particular function. Now, when I say any number, don't take it literally. Okay. But it can be a range or variety of answers possible. So when you say infinity to the power tending to zero, I'm just taking an example where that tending to zero is 1 by 1 followed by million zeros. Okay. And you're raising it to the power infinity, which means you are finding one, you can say one followed by millionth root of infinity. Okay. When I say 5 to the power 1/3, what does it mean? I'm finding such a quantity which multiplied thrice to itself will give me 5, right? This is the meaning of this, isn't it? Okay. So now, when you're finding this sixth root of infinity, you're seeking for a certain value, which when multiplied to itself, one followed by a million zeros, will give you this quantity, which is a very, very large number. Okay. So this quantity may be a substantial number. It may be a finite number. Now, what is that number? We can't comment. We can't tell you without evaluating the limit. Okay. So it can be determined, but not very clear from the given expression till we apply our tools of limits on it. Is that fine? Any questions here? Okay. Out of these 7 indeterminate forms, okay, the one that you will be studying in class 11th is the only first one. This is what you are going to study in class 11th. Okay. So when are you going to study the rest 6? The answer to that is, if you are a CBSE student, the answer is never. So you must be wondering, ayyo, sir, spend half an hour talking about these 6 indeterminate forms. Now he is saying only one of them will be taught to you in the school and all the 6 will not be taught to you. The answer is, unfortunately, in the school it will not be taught to you. Okay, unless until you are an IST student, but I'm assuming that most of you, in fact all of you, are from CBSE only. In IST they have another 6 forms also in 12th, but CBSE doesn't talk about them. But if you are a competitive exam aspirant, you will have to know all the 7 forms. Okay. So the bottom line is, if you are a board level candidate, if you are only preparing for school exams, then you don't have to study 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 and 7. Okay. So 2 to 7 is a no-go area for you. Only the first one you need to study. Okay. So even for our bridge course, I will only talk about the first one. Okay, so I'll not talk about 2 to 7 till we have, you know, learned higher versions of calculus, higher levels of calculus. Is that fine? So time has come now to see how do we cure these forms. So let's say now you are, you know, a doctor who has to find cures to indeterminate forms. So let me write down the topic name as methods to evaluate, okay, indeterminate forms. And I will talk specially 0 by 0 form. Okay, what about the other 6 forms? As I told you, we'll take up those forms little later on. Okay, when I say little later on, probably 5-6 months down the line. Okay, the first method that we normally use is the method of factorization. Now, first method doesn't mean that it's a method that you can apply anywhere. There are certain types of 0 by 0 form where you can apply factorization method. Okay, so it's like, see, let's say 0 by 0 is like a headache. Okay, let's say I'm comparing it to a disease. I have a headache or I have a sickness. Now, sickness, a headache could be of various types. It could be a migraine, right? It could be a sinusitis, right? It could be because, you know, you have a, poor sleep cycle. Okay, so what I'm doing is, let's say this is your headache problem, and I'm saying the headache is something which can be cured by factorization method. Okay, of course, headache cannot be cured by factorization. It could be cured by, let's say, light medicine, let's say crocin, or you can say a paracetamol or like that. Okay, not all the problems of 0 by 0 will be addressed by this. Try to understand this. So this is one of the methodologies that we normally adopt to cure 0 by 0 form. Okay, yeah, Shitish. Splitting headache problem. Yeah, right. So I'll give you an example for this. Let us say I'm evaluating limit extending to 1, x square minus 3x plus 2 upon x square minus 5x plus 4. Okay. Now, remember this very important thing that I'm going to tell you. Whenever you are given a limit problem, whichever problem, first always substitute this value of x in these two functions or whatever. You know, x, but wherever there is an x, put the value of x as this given term. That means your a. Okay, it either will give you a finite answer or it will show you that it's an indeterminate form. Correct. So whichever question is given to you, just listen to my steps very carefully, dear students. Whichever problem in this world is given to you on limits, first put the value of a into the function. If you get a finite answer, then be happy. That is your limit. Over. Job is over. Okay. That means the given function to you was continuous at that point a. This is my a, let's say. Okay. And you can evaluate your answer by just putting the value of x as a into the function. Okay. If, let's say, putting a into the function leads to an indeterminate form, that means, let's say, if you see 0 by 0 coming up, or if you see infinity by infinity coming up, or if you see infinity minus infinity coming up, or if you see tending to 0 into infinity coming up, or if you see 0 to the power 0 coming up, or if you see infinity to the power 0 coming up, in short, if you see any one of the 7 indeterminate forms coming up, that means it is a way for the function to tell you that, boss, don't try substitution on me, right? My problem is bigger than what you are thinking, right? See, it's like when a patient goes to the doctor, what does doctor try first? He'll try very light medicines. Probably he'll give you multivitamins, right? Probably he will give you some, you know, milder doses of the medicine, right? Nobody will, you know, give you you know hard medicine, right? Nobody will, okay, you have to be operated. Nobody will tell you, right? They'll first try to treat you with, you know, lighter doses of the medicine or multivitamins, or they might just advise you to change your way you eat or way you sleep. Okay, so that is what I'm saying, that first put the value in check. If it is giving you finite value, that means if, let's say, the patient got treated by a multivitamin, then why to do anything else? Be happy. Patient is happy, you are happy. Correct. So if you get a finite answer, the limit is done there and there itself. That finite value is your limit. But if you end up seeing a 0 by 0 coming up, or any of those 7 indeterminate coming up, that means the problem is more serious than what we are expecting it to be. Okay, so method of substitution will not work. So milder dose of the medicine or multivitamins are not going to work on that patient. You have to give him a severe treatment. Now, what is this treatment? The treatment here is factorization method. Okay. Now, what do we do in factorization method? Just try to understand this. When I put a 1 in this, you can see that numerator will become 0. By the way, it is not exactly 0, because x is not exactly 1. Getting my point? Okay. When you put 1 in the denominator, it shows you that it is 0 as well. But again, remember, it is not exactly 0. Right? They are actually tending to 0 by tending to 0. Right? But in the very fast world, we call it as 0 by 0 form. Even if you open your books like R.D. Sharma and all, you would hardly see the word tending to use anywhere. They'll just say 0 by 0 form, 0 by 0 form. Let it not, you know, change your understanding about the idea. It doesn't mean exactly 0 by exactly 0. Exactly 0 by exactly 0 cannot be found out. That's a gone case. Right? Think as if that patient is dead only. Nobody can save him. Tending to 0 by tending to 0 means there is a scope to save him. There is a scope to save him. There is an answer to that particular form. Okay. So what are you doing here? You are actually trying to see that there is a problem in the question when you get a 0 by 0. Okay. Now, when you get a 0 from a polynomial, it means that when I put, let's say, an value alpha in a polynomial and I get a 0 from it, what does it mean? You have done polynomials chapter, no, in class. And what does it mean? It means alpha is a 0 of the polynomial. Correct? Right? It also means that x minus alpha is a factor of that polynomial. Yes or no? Correct? So now what I'm trying to say is, when I put a 1 in place of x on the numerator, I realize I got a 0, which clearly indicates that x minus 1 has to be a factor of the numerator polynomial. Okay. And the other factor, I'm sure you can easily guess it out. It's not a big expression that you cannot factorize. The other factor was actually x minus 2. Okay. Similarly, in the denominator also, one of the factor is x minus 1 and the other is x minus 4. Correct. Now understand here, my students. The problem of 0 in the numerator and the problem of 0 in the denominator, as you can see here, this came because of these two guys. These two are the problem creating factors. Right? So they were responsible. So this is the virus, or this is the ailment bacteria for you, which was creating that headache, or which was creating that internal disease for you. Kill them. Correct. So limit is what? Limit is doing what? It is trying to surface out that, you know, problem creating factor. And once those problem creating factor are found out, you need to cancel it. Now here again a question arises. Sir, when you are canceling it, aren't you canceling 0 and 0, which is not allowed in maths? Again, my argument remains, x is tending to 1. It is not equal to 1. Right? It is not equal to 1. So these two quantities are infinitesimal quantities, but they are not 0. They are not 0. So you can cancel them off. Mathematics only stops you from canceling exact 0 with exact 0. It doesn't stop you from canceling two equal quantities which are tending to zero. You can definitely cancel them off. Okay. So once you cancel them off, you can see that the term that remains is this guy. And here you can put the value of one. So substitution, remember the first type of functions that I talked about where you could substitute the value of a into the function. Now you have to follow the same thing. You have to put x value as one here. And the answer that you'll end up getting is 1/3. This is your answer. This is going to be your answer. Okay. Anusha has a very good question. Sir, how do we identify problem factors? Very simple, Anusha. When you're putting a into a particular polynomial and it is giving you zero, okay, the problem creating factor will always be that x minus a. Simple as that. Correct? So just try to cancel out x minus a from both the numerator and denominator. Once you have canceled them out, the virus creating that problem is dead. Right? Once the virus is dead, you can easily substitute the value of a or 1 in this case and get your answer. Is this clear or not? This is how method of factorization works. Okay. Now, many people say, sir, you are very opportunistic. First of all, you cancel these claiming that x is not 1. And then you put the value of x equal to 1 to get your answer. How you know manipulative you are, right? See, this is something which again I'm telling you a tool to achieve your answer faster. Exactly, I should never put the value of x as 1 into the function. But if I don't follow this, my dear, it will take me 1-2 hours to solve the same simple question, isn't it? Will you ever like to solve this question by putting the values of x as 0.9, 0.99, 0.999 or 1.1, 1.01, 1.001? Never, right? I don't think so. You will ever like to take that approach to solve the question. So this is something which, of course, I'm manipulative here. I'm trying to cancel out claiming that they are not zero, but again, I'm putting x equal to 1. Okay, claiming that x is not 1, I cancel it out and then I put x equal to 1. Of course, I'm, you know, acting in a very, very manipulative way, but that's how it works. It works by giving us the answer in a much faster way. Is that fine? So is method of factorization clear to all of you? Okay. So what I'll do next is I'll give you some questions. Okay. Let's solve few questions. Okay. And then we'll move on to the next concept. Okay. So let me pull out some questions for you. I also wanted to ask you some conceptual questions, but I will do that in some time. Let's take this set of questions. You can see 6 questions here. Evaluate the following limit, but I don't want to do 6 questions here. Let's do a few of them. Let's take second one. Let's take fifth one, and let's take the sixth one. Okay, so we'll only do these 3. Rest of them you may try it out homework on your own. Okay, so let's try to solve the second one. Okay, let's try to solve the second one. In second one, I mean, I'm just giving you 90 seconds to think about it, then we'll pitch in. So you have to evaluate the limit of 3x square plus 5x plus 2 over 3x square minus 4x minus 4 when x tends to negative 2/3. Remember the first step which I told you, always put the value of x to which it is tending to in the expression. If it gives you finite, then you are lucky. That is your answer. But if it gives you 0/0, then you have to continue with the further process. Now, many people ask me, sir, is it necessary to do all these things? Because do you think that they will ever give you a expression where you can just put the value and you get a finite answer? See, the chances are very less, but again, you cannot ignore it. In one of the questions I thought in the previous class, remember, I think question number 6, fifth part or something, where you just have to put the value of x into the function and got your answer. Many people were like, you know, they were refusing to believe that it could be so simple. Okay. So first try putting the values. So Auro confirms that it is 0 by 0. Okay, Auro, you're absolutely correct. So go ahead. What is next thing you'll do? So substitution doesn't work. So it is not a case of continuous function. So what do we do next? Apply that. Okay, so I should get consistently the same answer from everybody. Then only I'll think that the idea has been well understood by you. So right now I can see two different answers coming up. Okay. Now three different answers have come up. One from Arabi, one from Shitij, one from Aryadilip. Let's see how many more answers I get to see. There you go. Now I see the fourth answer. Okay. So for second question, now thank you for giving me options, my dear students. Answers that I can see on my screen are these answers. Okay. Okay, I'll run a poll now. This is how your JEE questions and other competitive exams questions will be framed. They'll see what all possible mistakes people can do and they'll put that into the options. So now after solving it, please press on the poll button so that we can know how many of you have got the answer correct and how many of you have not got it correct. Okay, last 30 seconds, please conclude. It is not that difficult. Please conclude. So in another 20 seconds, I'll stop the poll. Okay, so at the count of five, I'll stop. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Stop. Why 9 people? Okay. Fine. So now 89% of you have gone with option D. Okay. And just 1% has gone for option A. Fine. So let's see whether D is right or not. See here. It's very clear that when you put a minus 2 by 3 in place of x, both the numerator and denominator would become a 0, right? I think there is no problem with that. Okay. Yeah, or let's discuss that. So I can predict here very well that if it is giving you 0, then x plus 2 by 3 will be a factor. Okay. To be more precise, 3x plus 2 will be a factor. Okay. So this is something which I can show with surety, not even prediction. I'm pakka sure that 3x plus 2 will come out as a factor. Okay, let's check it out by factorizing it. So what I'm going to do is in the numerator, I can see we can write this as 3x square plus 3x plus 2x plus 2. Okay, even the denominator, I can split it up as 3x square minus 6x plus 2x minus 4. Okay, no doubt about that. So let us move ahead with the factorizations part. One more thing, my dear students, till you have evaluated the limit, keep writing this. Keep writing LM, LIM, okay, or LT you can also write, LT. Many books will write LT also for limits. Both are acceptable notations. So till you have evaluated your final answer, keep writing it. The moment you stop writing it, your teacher will think that, oh, the limit has been evaluated, okay? So yeah, so when you take let's say 3x common, you get x plus 1, and here you take a 2 common, you get again x plus 1. Okay, and in the denominator also, if you take 3x common, you get x minus 2, and you take a 2 common, again you get x minus 2. Okay, so let me just finally factorize it. So 3x plus 2 times x plus 1 will be the factorization of the numerator polynomial, and 3x plus 2 times x minus 2 would be the factorization of the denominator polynomial. Now, as I rightly said, this factor will surface out, and the problem creating factors are these two guys, right? Kill them, eliminate them, remove them, whatever you want to understand. When whatever is left, you can substitute the value of negative 2 by 3 and you are done. So it gives you 1 third divided by minus 8 third, which is minus 1 by 8. So yes, my dear, option number D was correct. Okay. See, again a 0 by 0 form, but I got a different answer. That depends upon what is the expressions involved in that. Okay. So until unless you do all these drama, you cannot find the answer to that indeterminate form. Is the idea clear how it works? Okay. Let's now have quickly fifth question. Quickly, let's see who gives me the first answer. But not at the cost of accuracy. It's no point giving me the first answer wrong. Okay. So who gives me the first correct answer? So first try putting 1 into the numerator denominator. Is it coming out to be 0? Yeah, I can see that it's coming out to be 0, 0 each. So substitution is of no use. Let's have 90 seconds for it. Okay, so I've got the first answer. Oh my god, again, two different answers. So Shitesh, Arabi, both your answers are different from each other. Let's see what others have to say. Then I'll make an options out of it. Oh, Gurman also, Gurman answer is matching with one of you. Okay. So it's high chance that that person is correct. So this answer I'm writing down, it was minus 1 by 8. Anybody else? Let's have 30 seconds more. Let's have 30 seconds more. Nobody else wants to respond? Auro, Priyam, Mriganka, Muskan, Oshik, Pradyun. Okay, Anusha. Anusha is giving me different answer. Okay. Guys, buck up fast. Yeah, sure. Okay. Let me give you 30 seconds. Okay, let's have 1 minute. Let's have 1 minute. So I can see now 3 answers on the board. Yeah, Auro. I saw your answer, Auro. I'm not saying right or wrong to it. We'll discuss after 30 seconds more. Okay, Arya Dilip, good. So now I have got 4 answers coming from you for the fifth one. Okay, the options are
minus 5, 5 by 4, 1 by 4, and minus 1 by 4. So these are the options. Okay. Just would like to quickly give me a, you know, quick poll for this. Okay. Just to see what is the number of people who are, you know, choosing these options. I'm sure there's nobody like none of these. Fast. You've already solved the problem. I've given you enough time to do it. Okay. So please press on the poll button just for the sake of confirming how many people have voted for a given option. Okay. So most of you have gone for B option. Okay. Let's see whether B is correct or not. See here, everybody, please try to understand. You definitely know that x minus 1 is going to be a factor of the numerator as well as the denominator, right? So the problem statement that you have now in front of you is that if one of the factors is x minus 1, what are the other factors, or what is the other factor? Okay, so for that, what will you do? You will basically factorize it, but now it is a biquadratic, okay, or cubic also. It is very difficult to factorize it. Factorization worked very fine in the second equation, but now when the degree of the polynomial grows higher, it becomes equally difficult for us to factorize. So what will you do? You could do long division, correct? You do a long division, right? So most of you have done that. Okay. Now people who have done long division, I'm not saying this is something wrong, but it takes time to do long division, right? The name itself says long division. So I will tell you an easier way to actually perform the same division in a much faster way. Okay. By the way, I'm just following the long division method just to confirm whether whatever I'm doing is correct with this. So first you multiply with x cube. Okay. So this is what you get. Fine. Subtract it. You get minus 2x cube plus 2. So you'll put a minus 2x square. That will give you minus 2x cube here and a plus 2x square. Again, when you subtract, you get minus 2x square plus 2. Again, you put a minus 2x. So it'll give you minus 2x square plus 2x. Again, when you subtract, you get minus 2x plus 2. And then you finally put a minus 2. Okay. And this is how you end up getting your, you know, quotient or the other factor. Correct? Now the same thing, I'll do it in a much faster and convenient way. Okay, without, you know, wasting too much space also. So I'm going to use a method which we call as Horner's method. Okay. Some people also like to call it as synthetic division. Okay. Now, before I start, let me tell you, this method has some shortcomings. Shortcoming means some drawbacks. It can only work when you're dividing a polynomial function by a linear divisor. Okay. This only works when your divisor is a degree one polynomial. Okay. And most of us, we prefer using it when we have divisors where you have terms of the nature x minus an integer or x plus an integer. Okay. So preferably, I don't say that it will not work for, let's say, if you're dividing by, let's say, 2x minus 1. It will work. But it works very fine or fast when you have a divisor of the nature x minus or x plus an integer. Okay. So in this case, your divisor is x minus 1, isn't it? Okay. So this is an integer, so it works very fine in this case. And this is also of degree 1. Okay. Your dividend, this is called your dividend. I'm sure you are aware of the terms that we use. Okay. Dividend is something which we are dividing. Divisor is something with which we are dividing. Quotient is basically what you get on the top. Remainder is what you get here in the bottom. So this is your quotient. Okay. So right now we are finding quotient
Okay. And I'll also tell you that this method will give you the remainder also. In this case, your remainder is zero. In this case, your remainder is zero, right? Okay, this is called the remainder. Now, what is this method? So there are certain things that we need to, precautions that we need to exercise while applying this method. First of all, the dividend has to be arranged in descending powers of x without missing out any power of x in it. Now, what do I mean by that? If you see this expression, x to the power 4 minus 3x cube plus 2, you realize that it is arranged in the descending powers of x, but x square term is not there. Not only that, x term is also not there. So then first, process or the first step of the process before you apply Horner's method is first write down your dividend in a decreasing power of x without missing any power of x. It means that if you don't have an x square and if you don't have an x, put a zero next to it or put a coefficient of zero with it. Okay. Next is write down the coefficients of these powers of x that you have written, starting from x to the power 4 all the way till x to the power 0. Okay, so coefficients are 1, that is, these numbers are called coefficients. Okay, so 1, minus 3, 0, 0, and 2. Any questions here? Are these steps of the process clear? First, write it down in descending power of x without missing out any power of x. Okay. Now, make a weird symbol like this just for your reference. You can make any symbol you want. Since you're dividing by x minus 1, write a 1 over here. Okay. So, obvious question will arise. What if I was dividing by x plus 1? Then I would write a minus 1 here. Are you getting my point? If you're dividing with x minus 3, write a 3 over here. If you're dividing with x plus 3, then write a minus 3 over here. Understood? Okay. Next is a very important set of steps. Please listen to this carefully. We always write a 0 before the first coefficient. So for this, before beneath 1, you'll always write a 0. So beneath this 1, you'll always write a 0. Okay. Now add it. Add 1 plus 0. 1 plus 0 is 1. Then multiply this with this. So these two will get multiplied. These two will get added up. Okay. 1 into 1 will be 1. Okay. Write it over here. Again, add this. Again, multiply with a 1. Write it over here. Again, add this. Again, multiply with a 1. Write it over here. Again, add this 2. Again, multiply with a 1 and write it over here. And you realize that finally, when you add, you'll end up getting a 0. Is these steps clear to you? Again, I'm repeating it. You start by writing a 0 below this 1, add 1 and 0, you get a 1. Multiply whatever number you have over here, since you are dividing it by x minus 1, there is a 1 over there. So multiply these two numbers and write it to the next one below here. Then again add these two, whatever you get, again multiply with that 1, write it over here. So again these two will multiply and you write it over here. Right? Keep doing it. If you keep doing this, you realize that you'll end up seeing these five numbers. Okay, the last number is reserved for remainder. Always. The last number is always reserved for remainder. Okay, so as you can see, your remainder is zero. That's why this came out to be zero. But if it's, let's say, some other number, then that number will become the remainder. Okay. Again, see, Ashitesh, it works because you're dealing with the same thing, but you're dealing with coefficients. If you see the entire process in terms of coefficients, you would realize that why it works. It is not a, rocket science. It is basically a Vedic process, right? Which Horner made his own process. If you just see, you are actually dealing with only coefficients. Okay. Try it out why it works. Okay. Everybody will be able to figure it out on your own. Now, I'm not done yet. What are these remaining numbers? What are these remaining numbers? Let's talk about it. These remaining numbers actually contain the data about the quotient.
And you must be thinking, how is this giving me the quotient? Very simple. Start writing from this number and start going towards the first number. And attach powers of x starting from 0 to each numbers. For example, minus 2 x to the power 0. Again, this minus 2 x to the power 1. Again, this minus 2 x to the power 2. Again, this 1 x to the power 3. Right? And there you go. This actually gives you the quotient. Okay, so this becomes your quotient. Okay, so you can see that if you are used to this process, trust me, boys and girls, you can do this long division method in half the time, not even half the time, one third the time. And it is very much space efficient also. Okay, so let us say now I want to divide this divisor, this dividend by x minus 1. See how fast I will do. Okay, so basically I have to divide. Okay, let me just copy that question. The question was, by the time I drag it, I forget the question. X cube minus 5x square plus 3x plus 1. X cube minus 5x square plus 3x plus 1. Okay, let's say I want to divide this by x minus 1. See, by Horner's method, how fast it will be. I will write 1 minus 5, 3, 1. See, as all the coefficients, as all the powers of x are present, we don't have to worry too much to place 0. Okay, place a 1, 0, 1, 1, minus 4, minus 4, minus 1, minus 1, 0. Okay, and your quotient will be this. Quotient will be this. Done. So I did that entire working of long division just in this small space. Just in this small space. I not only got my remainder, I also got my quotient. Is that fine? Any questions with respect to Horner's method? Of course, you would like to practice more. We'll apply the same thing in the next question. Okay, so that will act as a practice. Now, let me complete the question. Let me complete the question. As of now, we have just understood Horner's method. So this limit that you have, you can break that up as x minus 1. X cube minus 2x square minus 2x minus 2 by x minus 1, and I think what I had got over here was x square minus 4x minus 1. Okay, so by doing this factorization, you have surfaced out the problem creating factor. Now, this guy was creating trouble for us. This guy was responsible for that 0 by 0 occurring. Just eliminate them, remove them. Now, whatever is left, you are free to substitute there. So when you put the value here, you end up seeing, okay, and the answer here is clearly minus 5 by minus 4, minus 5 by minus 4, which is 5 by 4. So this becomes your answer. Okay, so option number, I think yes, B, Janta was right, B was the correct option. Now, before I move on to the next question, okay. Many people ask me, sir, let's say you remove this factor and now you put again the value of x as 1 and still let's say it gave you 0 by 0. Then what do you do in that case? See, if it again gives you 0 by 0, what does it indicate? It indicates that there is still x minus 1 factor hidden in those remaining factors. So you have to again take them out. Correct? That means factorization is not complete. That means these terms will still have those, you know, if they're giving you 0 by 0, let's say hypothetically, then they will still have x minus 1 factors in them. So again, you need to take them out. Again, you need to cancel them. And then again, you need to substitute. Keep doing it till you stop getting any indeterminate form as your answer. Is that fine? Is that fine? Any questions here? Okay. I would like you to apply Horner's process once more. For that, I would give you, can we do a fourth question also? Because you'll get a chance to apply Horner's process, at least in the denominator part of it. Can you all apply it to the fourth one? Everybody, please. Now, I want to see how much time you take to solve the question. one second,
before you proceed, this should be x cube. Sorry. This should be x cube. Okay. Yes. Because then only it'll give you a zero.
Denominator is 27 plus 9 minus 18 minus. Huh. Denominator is fine.
Yeah. So now apply the Horner's method to do the factorization of it. Now let's see how much time you take to solve this.
In fact, we'll take these two questions on the next slide so that it is not muddled up. Oh, sorry. Where is that gone?
Okay, privately let me know what is the answer. Okay, Auro. Does it take so much time? I was expecting that you'll give me the answer within 1 minute. Okay, so to factorize the numerator, you'll end up getting x square plus 3x plus 5. Okay. So it will give you limit x tending to 3, x minus 3, x square plus 3x plus 5. Okay. So let me now similarly do the denominator. Okay. Kshitij has also got the same answer. So most probably you both are correct. So let me do the denominator. See how fast I will do. So it'll give you 9 plus 9, 18. 18 plus 5, 23. And you'll get 9 plus 12, 21. 21 plus 6, 27. This is the answer. Okay. I don't think so. It would have crossed 30 seconds also. Okay. So this is the speed that you're expected to solve the question with. So thanks to this Horner method that we are able to get the answer so fast. Now please attempt the sixth one. So this was your fourth one. Please attempt the sixth one. Let's see. Now, since base is not mentioned here for the log, you can treat it to be E. Okay. In calculus, when the base is not mentioned, we take the base to be E. Done. Is it so lengthy? I thought you guys will do it in fraction of a second. Okay. I'll give you another 30 seconds. No issues. Anusha, I don't think so. That's correct, dear. Just check your working once again. Shitesh, that's right. Shitesh, you're right. Arya Dilip, you're also correct. Okay, I think enough time has been given for this question. Now here, I know that the problem creating factor is x minus 2. Correct? That is very much there in the denominator. But in the numerator, I have to work hard to factorize that particular factor out. Now, the moment I see x square and I see a minus 4, it rings a bell in my mind that x minus 2 can come from there. So what I'll do is, I'll group those two terms together. Okay, so the first term and the last term, I'll group together. And the other term, I can take a minus x common. In fact, you can take a minus log x common and you end up getting again x minus 2. Something of this nature. No, Auro, that's not correct. Okay. Now you can factorize this as x minus 2, x plus 2, minus log x, x minus 2. Okay. Please write it like this, else you will feel that it is log of x into x minus 2. Now, x minus 2 has clearly surfaced out in both these expressions. Okay. And this is the remaining factor on the numerator. So eliminate these two problem creating factors. The moment you eliminate it, you are free to substitute. So your answer will be 2 plus 2 minus log 2. That is nothing but 4 minus log 2. 4 minus log 2. Is that fine? Was it difficult? I don't think so. I think you grouped up wrong terms to factorize. Did you do that? Okay, you probably would have wasted wrong, time by grouping up wrong terms. At first, yes. Okay. So now, this is one method. But again, this method also has its shortcoming, also has its loopholes. Let me give you a question which you cannot or probably will not be able to solve by the previous approach. Let's say, I ask you to solve this. Limit extending to minus 3, x square minus 9 by under root of x square plus 16 minus 5. Okay, this 5 is outside the under root. Okay, like this. Okay, now let's solve this limit. Now let's try to see whatever we have learned in our past, which will help us to solve this. Of course, we'll not go back to the informal approach. Here you can see numerator is a polynomial, right? That can be factorized. So x plus 3 is the problem creating factor. So this guy, x plus 3 is the problem creating factor. This is the problem for us. Okay, numerator is factorizable. That is fine. But now denominator is creating a problem. Denominator is not a polynomial. It's an irrational function, so as to say. So we cannot factorize it. Okay. And I'm sure method of substitution also will surrender. It will not work. I think the first thing that you should always do is method of substitution. So 9 minus 9 by 25 root minus 5. 0 by 0. No help from, substitution, no help from factorization as well. So what do we do in such cases? No, Shitesh, answer is not zero. So in such cases, there is another method that we call as method of rationalization,
method of rationalization. This method will come to our rescue. Okay, so in this case, what I am going to do is I am going to quickly rationalize the denominator.
Okay,
so I'm going to quickly rationalize the denominator. So what do you think will be the rationalization factor for this? You'll say simple, sir, it is the same thing with the plus sign in between, correct? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to multiply and divide with the rationalization factor of the denominator. Is that fine? Okay, let's see what grade we did we achieve by doing this. In the numerator, it is just going to stay as it is. Okay, let's not disturb our denominator. Let's not disturb our numerator. By mistake, I said denominator. But in the denominator, you can see you have the formula of a minus b times a plus b, which is nothing but a square minus b square. Okay. Let me tell you, these questions will come as it is in your unit tests or in your semester exams of your school. Okay. So then you will thank me for doing these questions in the bridge course itself. Okay. If you further simplify, you can clearly see that not only, you know, x minus 3 has come as a common factor in both numerator and denominator, but this entire term has come out as a factor. So you can save your time. You can cancel them off. Okay. Basically, x plus 3 will also get cancelled along with them. So that problem creating virus is gone along with those two terms which I have cancelled. So whatever is left, now you are free to substitute. From second to third. See, what I did was, what I did, Oro, was when I multiplied the denominator, I used a minus b a plus b formula, okay, which is a square minus b square. So when you square this term, the under root sign goes off, and 5 when you square, you get a 25, right? So x square minus 9 will appear in the denominator, that will cancel with this x square minus 9 on top. So both x square minus 9 terms are gone, and that x plus 3, which was your problem, okay, so this was the problem, right? This was the problem that also got killed there with those terms. Okay, sorry for using such non-violent terms like killed and eliminate. Okay, that also got cancelled with that term. Okay, now whatever is left, you can easily use your substitution. Substitution will give you under root 25 plus 5. That's nothing but 10. 10 is your answer for this question. Is that okay? Is the process understood? Okay. Now let me tell you before I give you a few more questions. Problem number 6, where do you solve? Okay, Anusha has a doubt. Okay, in problem 6, last board. Okay, Anusha, I'm going to that board. Just excuse us for a time being. Yes, Anusha. Yeah, Anusha, tell me, dear.
There's minus x log x and then plus 2 log x. So because we're going to 2, can't it be minus 2 log x plus 2 log x and that becomes 0?
Where?
In the numerator, we have minus x log x and then plus 2 log x. So then doesn't that become minus 2 log x plus 2 log x? So that's 0.
You're talking from this step to this step, huh?
No, sir. If you look at the problem.
If I look at the problem, okay.
Yeah, sir. There we have minus x log x and then plus 2 log x. So when we substitute 2, we have minus 2 log 2 plus 2 log 2. That becomes 0, right?
Why only that? Even x square and 4 will become 0. That's the whole point. No, it is 0 by 0 form.
Okay.
The whole problem is 0 by 0. That's why it is a problem for us. Else we would have substituted and, you know, done and dusted with the question, right? The problem is not only these two terms, Anusha, but even these two terms will give you, you know, they'll cancel off. Everything will be zero actually, not only in the numerator, but also in the denominator. That's the whole point. Let's go to the initial point of our discussion. We are now handling which forms? Indeterminate forms. And zero by zero is a type of indeterminate form. So all the questions in this list you will see will be a zero by zero form. Okay.
Substitution cases, we are not going to talk about because they are too easy to be asked in any competitive exams or even for the school exams. Okay. So with this, I would like to test you with more questions. Okay, let's see. Now, this problem may give you a wrong notion that it is always the denominator which is factorized. No, it is not the case. It all depends upon question to question. Okay, sometimes you may need to rationalize the numerator. Sometimes even both numerator and denominator needs to be rationalized. Okay, so we'll take a few questions of these types. So let us take this one. I'll write it down. Limit x tending to 0. Under root of 1 plus x square minus under root of 1 plus x by x. Okay, Anusha, just for your reference, this is again a 0 by 0. Because when you put 0, root 1 and root 1 will cancel out. Okay, you get a 0 on the numerator. Even the denominator will give you a 0. So 99.99% questions you will come across in limits will be of an indeterminate form. Let's try this out. Let's see who gets this correct. So here, remember, the problem creating factor is x itself. This itself is the problem creating factor. So do not substitute till you have cancelled out that problem creating factor. So denominator, it is very obvious. You can see it sitting in the denominator. Numerator, it is hidden. So you have to do something to surface that out, to bring that out. Done. Very good. Gurman has given one answer. I'm not saying right or wrong to it, Gurman. Shitij, no, that is not the answer. Again, Shitij, if you're getting some infinity or minus infinity kind of scenario, better write it as does not exist. Okay, because limit itself cannot be an infinite quantity, whether positive infinity or negative infinity. Okay. Left hand limit, right hand limit, maybe. But for limit, if you are getting such an answer, you should always say does not exist. Okay. But others are getting consistently the same answer. So I'm getting three types of answers. Some of you say half. Some of you say minus half. And one person is saying minus infinity. Let's see if I'm getting more options. Okay, Priyam. Okay, now Shitij has changed his answer. Okay. Fine. So let's take this up. Others? Muskan? Anusha, Arabi? Oshik? Parvati? Pradyun? Shanmukh? Okay. Chalo, we'll discuss it. So now in this case, we have to rationalize the numerator part. Okay. So a numerator, you can see that the rationalization factor of the numerator would be the same set of terms, but with a plus sign in between. Okay. So I'm just going to write it, the question first. This is my question. And now I'm going to multiply my numerator as well as my denominator with the rationalization factor of the numerator. This is the rationalization factor. Correct? Correct? Now, in the numerator, you have something like a minus b, a plus b. So that becomes a square minus b square. That's the whole point of rationalizing it, right? That it should become a square minus b square. So when I do that, I end up getting this minus this. Okay. In denominator, let us not disturb any term. Let it be copied as such. Okay. Now, when I open the brackets, 1 and 1 will get cancelled off, and I'll end up getting x square minus x. X square minus x is like this. Okay. Now, it is at this stage that your problem creating factor has surfaced out. Okay. X and x have surfaced out in the numerator and denominator. Cancel them out. Once you have cancelled, you are free to substitute. Once you substitute, you end up getting minus 1 by 2 as your answer. So that is the answer that most of you have given. Well done. Very good. People who have given half, I think they would have made a sign mistake somewhere. Please check your answer. Okay. Auro, yeah. Yeah. Now let us take a question where you would need a rationalization both on the numerator and denominator. Okay. So let me take up a problem. Let's say x tending to a under root of a plus 2x minus under root of 3x by under root of 3a plus x minus 2 under root x. Okay. A is some constant, a is some value to which x is tending to. Let's try this again. It's a 0 by 0 form. You can simply substitute your x as a and check. So the numerator will become under root of 3a minus under root of 3a, isn't it? That will become a 0. Denominator will become 2 under root a minus 2 under root a. Even that is 0. So the whole problem is that we are now dealing with an indeterminate form. Okay. Let's see what answers you get. Let's try it out. I'll give you 2 minutes for this. Okay, Kshitij, let's see what others get. Okay, Arabi, not saying right or wrong to anybody. Let's see a few more responses. So in this question, you would realize that you have to rationalize both the numerator and denominator, right? So on the numerator, the rationalization factor would be a plus 2x plus under root of 3x. Okay, so let's multiply and divide with it. Okay, so if you're multiplying it with something, please do not forget to divide it by the same thing, else you are going to change that expression. So we have to deal without changing our given question. Okay, now denominator's rationalization factor, I will write it in some different color. So let me take a green color, or let me take a orange color. Okay, so for the rationalization factor of the denominator, I have to multiply and divide it with a 3a plus x plus 2 root x. Okay. Now, what you can do here is these two will club and these two will club. Okay. Whatever don't club, let them be as they are. So a minus b, a plus b, what will it give you? A square minus b square. Okay, and this orange term will remain as it is. This orange term will remain as it is. Okay, in the denominator, these two will club up, so it will become 3a plus x minus 4x, and this white term will remain as it is. Getting the point? Okay. So now, which is the problem creating factor? The problem creating factor is this guy, x minus a. This is the problem. I have to cancel this problem somehow from my given expression. So what I'm going to do is, everybody please see, this term, if you open the bracket, you end up getting a minus x. Check it out. This term will give you 3a minus x. Okay, till I've evaluated, let me keep writing this. The other terms, please do not disturb them. Let them be in peace. Okay, let them be in peace. Do not disturb them. Keep writing them as they are. Okay, now this a minus x or x minus a, whatever you want to call them, which was creating a problem for us, now it is eliminated. Once it is eliminated, now you are free to substitute. So when you substitute back the value of x as a in this, you end up getting, now see here, in the numerator, you end up getting 4 under root a, so which is 2 under root a. So 2 under root a, 2 under root a. In the denominator, you end up getting root of 3a plus root of 3a. Okay, which is as good as saying 1 by 3 into 2 root a by root of 3a. Root of 3, root of a. Root a, root a gone. So answer will be 2 by 3 root 3. 2 by 3 root 3. And till I had seen, nobody had given the right answer. Now I think Pradyun has given it correct. Pradyun has given it correct. Okay. Gurman, I think slight mistake is there. Yeah, now Shitij, your answer is correct. Okay. Is this fine? Okay. So any question here, please ask me. So this was an example where both your numerator and denominator, they needed rationalization. Okay, as compared to the previous two, where only one of them needed rationalization. Fine, any question, any doubt? How do you know what to club together? That's a very simple question to answer, because only x minus y, x plus y terms can be clubbed together. Only the rationalization factors could be clubbed together. So this can club with this only, right? And this can club with this. Right? Okay. Let me ask you next question. Let's see who gives this a response. X to the power a, limit x tending to 8. X to the power 1/3 minus 2 by x minus 8. Let's solve this. Again, you can check both numerator and denominator will become zero when you substitute x as 8. So again, a 0 by 0 form. Yes, Arya, tell me. What's your doubt? You can unmute yourself also and talk. Won't the denominator become 4 root a? Are you talking about the previous question? Okay, let me go back to the previous question. Yeah, so your denominator will become root of 3a plus root of 3a, which is 2 root of 3a. Numerator will become 4 root a, but again I cancel out the 2 factor. No, so it is actually this. I probably did not write that step. It is 3 into 2 times 2 root a, and denominator also is 2 times root of 3a. So these two got cancelled off. Sorry, I did not write that down because, okay. And then this root 3 into root a, I separated it out. This I wrote as root 3 into root a, and then I cancelled this off. So it is 2 by 3 root 3. Okay, fine. Okay, so Pradyun has given me an answer for this. Okay, Pradyun. Shitej has given an answer. Both your answers are different. Still different. Let me see a few more responses. Okay, Arabi. Okay, let's have a quick discussion on it. See, the main reason why I gave this problem is because I wanted to break a misconception. The misconception is the choice of the rationalization factor. Many people, they have a misconception that rationalization factor is nothing but a factor which has the same terms but with a opposite sign in between. Okay, so many people wrongly believe that the numerator's rationalization factor will be this x to the power 1 by 3 plus 2. Please let me tell you, no. That changing of sign thing works only for under root or square root kind of a scenario. It doesn't work for a cube root kind of a scenario. Getting my point? So the whole point of rationalization factor, see, let me write this 2 as 8 to the power 1/3. Now, when I want to rationalize the numerator, basically I'm looking for such a factor which multiplies to this to give me x minus 8. That means it makes x and 8 free from those radical powers. Okay, that is what I mean by making them rational. Okay, so now I would like to ask you, if you want to make a minus b as a cube minus b cube, what do you actually multiply it with? This is just like asking you the factorization of a cube minus b cube. So I know all of you know the result. It is a square plus ab plus b square, right? So that becomes your rationalization factor. So in this example which I have given, the rationalization factor would be, now think this is a and this is your b,
So a is x to the power 1 by 3 and b is 8 to the power 1 by 3, which is 2 actually. So a square, okay, plus ab, this into 2, ab, plus b square. This would be your rationalization factor. So when I'm solving this question, my dear, I'm going to multiply and divide with that term in the numerator and denominator. So x to the power 1 by 3 minus a to the power 1 by 3. I'm going to multiply and divide with x to the power 2 by 3. 2 into x to the power 1 by 3 plus 4. Both in the numerator and denominator. Okay. So as a result, what happens? The numerator, after you multiply these two, it becomes x minus 8. So the numerator becomes an x minus 8. Okay. And my whole point is to cancel out x minus 8 because that is my problem creating factor. That is my problem creating factor, which thankfully has, you know, happened in this case. And I'm just left with 1 by this term, and you can substitute 8 there. So 8 to the power 2 by 3. 2 into 8 to the power 1 by 3 plus 4. We all know 8 to the power 2 by 3 is going to give you a 4. 2 into 8 to the power 1 by 3 will be a 4 again, plus a 4. Okay, so your answer is going to be straight away 1 by 12. That's it. Okay. I think Shitij was the first one to get this right. Then Arabi got it. And of course, Arya Dilip. Yes, yes, yes. You can do that as well. You can do that as well. Okay. So basically, you may expand the denominator also and work with it. That is also fine. That is also fine. Okay. So what Shitish told, Shitish treated this as this. Okay. And he wrote AQ minus BQ formula. That is also fine. Later on, you will see that there is one more method to solve these kind of questions. And that is even much faster than this. Okay. So before I go on to any other standard form of limits, now there are certain methods, there are certain standard limits. Okay. I'm going to introduce some very important tools in front of you. Those tools will be not only helpful in this chapter, but it will be a learning for your life. Oh, sorry, Oro, I'm going back. Oro wants to see something. Yeah, Aro. Any questions here? Should I drag up, down, left, right? Down. Okay, this stage. Let me know once you're done. So meanwhile, you're copying. Let me just talk to the students. See, now I'm going to introduce a certain, you know, set of expansions for you, which are going to be very useful, not only for limits chapter, but also for your future part. You're definitely going to study it in graduate course in your, you know, engineering entrance, engineering colleges. Okay, so sooner or later you would require those tools. Okay, so it's good that you know them from now onwards only, so that as and when you feel the need for it, you can use them to solve your different types of problems. So those are basically certain expansions, okay, which is going to be very, very helpful for you in limits problem as well as in future concepts. Okay, so let me name the concept as some important expansions. The first of that expansion which I'm going to introduce is what we call as binomial expansion. Now, some of you might already be knowing it. Okay. Priyam, this is not done here. Once I've moved on, you're asking me again to go back. You should stop me then and there, no? Full mood was there to discuss it. Yeah. How did you cancel? Oh, you had asked it before. My bad. Sorry. My mistake. Sorry. Yeah. What did I cancel, Priyam? X minus 8. Yeah, because this becomes x minus 8, no? Multiplication here, x minus 8. This is also x minus 8. So I cancel them off. Got it? See, that's what I pointed this out. The multiplication is giving you x minus 8, this into this. Okay? Okay. Yeah, so yeah, I was talking about certain important expansions. So one of them is the binomial expansion. So you'll need this concept not only in this chapter of limits, but you'll also require it in the binomial theorem chapter, which is coming for you in class 11th. And you'd also need it in the future concepts like, you know, integration and all in your, you know, higher studies of maths. What is this expansion? Everybody try to listen to me. Okay. This expansion says 1 plus x to the power of n, okay, is given by 1 plus nx, n into n minus 1 by 2 factorial x square. Now, here I will take a pause. Who has not seen this kind of a term before? Factorial. Just let me know so that I can just take few minutes to discuss it. Factorial. How many of you have never heard of this factorial term before? All of you have heard factorial? Permutation combination chapter? Okay, Auro has not heard. Okay. Even if one person has not heard, let me discuss it. It's not a very difficult thing. Factorial is basically a notation in maths. It is normally written as a number followed by a exclamation mark, okay, where this number must be a whole number. So factorial is always found for whole numbers. Okay, we cannot find factorial for fractions. We cannot find factorials for negative integers. Okay, what does it mean, by the way? It is a short form of saying product of all numbers starting from n and going all the way till a 1. Right? So let's say if I say 4 factorial, it is a short form of saying 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. That's 24. It's a, you know, short form of writing 24. Okay. If I say 3 factorial, it means 3 into 2 into 1. That's 6. Okay. Oh, you know it. Okay. Fine. Okay. So let me give you a few more. 2 factorial is what? 2 factorial is 2. Okay, what is 1 factorial? 1. Okay, what is 0 factorial? What is 0 factorial? 0 factorial is also 1. That is also 1, right? Okay, we'll talk about it. We'll talk about this more on this in PNC chapter. Okay, more on this in PNC chapter. What is PNC? Permutations and combinations. Okay, so that's a chapter for you in class 11th, right? Yeah, so now let me continue with this binomial expansion. So the next term here would be n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 x cube by 3 factorial. Okay, and it'll go dot 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 dot. Now dot 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 means some kind of, you know, surprising element is there. Okay, now see, I've stopped at writing some dots. It doesn't mean I'm going to infinity, right? It doesn't mean I'm going to infinity. I've just written some dot. Okay, let me explain you why I stopped there. Now, if you follow the trend, the next term would be n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3, x to the power 4 by 4 factorial. It'll keep on going like that. Okay. Now, all of you, please listen to this very carefully. If n is a whole number, that means if this exponent, this is called the exponent or the power. If the power is a whole number, this series, this is called a series. Okay. Series is basically when you have a certain sequence added up, that is called series. Then this series will stop after n plus 1 terms. Okay, let me give you an example. 1 plus x to the power of 3. Okay, Let us start. One. I'm just copying this series, okay? Nx. N is 3. 3x. Then nn minus 1 by 2 factorial x square. That is 3 into 2 by 2 x square. Of course, 2, 2 will get cancelled. So, you'll get 3x square. This will be 3, 2, 1 by 3 factorial, which is 6, as you all told me that you are aware of factorials. Okay. Now, after this, if you write, let's say if you continue the trend, you will write 3 into 2 into 1 into 0. Correct? And there is no point writing it because once a 0 appears in your expression, everything will become a 0 from there on. Correct? Which means the expansion is limited to only these terms. And you very well know that it is the, you know, expansion of a plus b the whole cube. And you can see how many terms are there? How many terms are there? 4 terms. That is n plus 1 terms. You can check 1 plus x whole square. You will have only 3 terms. 1, x square and 2x. Right? So when n is a whole number, this dot 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 will stop somewhere. And it'll stop there where your 0 starts appearing. Getting my point? Getting my point? If n is not a whole number, let's say n is not a whole number. Not a whole number means it can be negative integer. It can be fractions. Negative, positive, both fractions are possible. Then what will happen in this case, my dear? The series will never stop. The series will go till infinite terms. That's why the dot dot dot, I did not, you know, mention infinity or anything. It may stop if your n is a whole number. It will not stop. That means it will be a non-stop term if n is not a whole number. Why it will not stop? Very simple. When you're writing these trend, you'll realize that for a negative integer or for a fraction, that zero thing will never come. That zero thing will never come because you're always decreasing it by integer values. Correct? So even if you write n, n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3, n minus 4, n minus 5, n minus 6, n minus 7, wherever we want to go, if n is a negative integer, no. Or n is a fraction, no. That will never become a zero. And therefore, the series will never stop. Okay? But in this case, I would just like to highlight over here, when your series never stops, you need to follow this restriction. Mod of x should be less than 1. Now, can somebody tell me why? All of a sudden, why did I put this restriction here? Any idea? Why did I put such a restriction? Just want to see your... by the way, my dear students, I've already floated up a group in the WhatsApp for people who will be taking up commerce stream and they still want to study maths. Of course, commerce students also have to study the board level maths. So please join that group. Okay, that will be a different kind of that level will be very different from the level of the regular class. Okay, we will be soon floating a group for APs and SAT combined. Okay, APs and SAT combined, but in a week's time. Okay, so people who are willing to write APs or SATs, please join that group. Both this commerce batch and this AP and SAT batches will happen online only throughout the year. There will be very few physical interactions. Okay, I'm not saying it will be never be a physical class, but very few physical interactions. Okay, mostly the classes will happen online. And trust me, and that batch will be very, very small. So one-to-one interaction will be much higher in that case. So like your group only, there are hardly 12 or 13 students here. Okay. So there's no commerce in NPS Koramangala. Who told you that? NPS Koramangala doesn't offer commerce. There are no commerce students. Are you sure? Okay. Okay.
Sorry, I was not aware of that. But in case somebody just wants to, okay, it is just also for those students who just want maths or board levels, even though they have taken science, but I don't want to go for any JEE or any kind of KVPY and all. I'm happy with board level maths. I want to score 100 on 100 in boards. You can also join that group. Okay. Is it fine? Okay. Now, coming to this question from Arya Dilip. How can mod x ever be negative? Okay. Arya Dilip, where have I said mod x is negative, my dear? Where have I said mod x is negative here? I said less than 1. Less than 1 or 0 ke beech mein bahut sare numbers aate hain. Right? Right? So I've never said it is negative. I just said the mod of the number is less than 1. Okay. In other words, I want to say x lies between minus 1 to 1. Okay. Now my question is why? Why it should be following this particular restrictions? Now the answer to this is slightly, you know, we can say you have to be a good, you know, heavy thinker for that. See, if you are going till infinite terms, okay, and as you can see, the powers of x are continuously growing. From x square, it has become x cube, it has become x to the power 4, and so on and so forth. Correct? If you are dealing with such x's whose mod is greater than or equal to 1, even equal to 1, what will happen? The right side of this expression, okay, or you can say the series part of this expression, they will become infinitely big. Whereas the left side of this expression, which is 1 plus x to the power n, that would be a finite quantity. So it would be wrong to say that a infinitely big quantity is equal to a finite quantity. So both these quantities cannot be compared. So how is this helping me in that case? It is actually making my series a convergent series. Now convergent is basically a very heavy word. Okay. People who are going to write APs, you will have to study about convergent, divergent, conditionally convergent and all. So if you join that AP and SAT group, we'll discuss that. It's a chapter in itself. Convergent means even if you are summing that for infinite terms, the answer will be still finite. I'll give you an example. Something which is a convergent series. An example of a convergent series. There are many types of natures of infinite series that we say. One is convergent, other is divergent, other is conditionally convergent and all those stuff. What is convergent series? Convergent series, an example would be something of this nature. Okay. Even if you sum this type of term 1 plus half plus 1 fourth plus 1 eighth plus 1 16th plus 1 32, even to infinite terms, you know this answer will be what? Anybody who knows the answer for this? Kshitij knows. It's just 2. Okay. So despite summing anything for infinitely many terms, you are getting a finite answer. It means that particular series is convergent. So if I don't keep this mod x less than 1, I will not get my right hand side of the equal to sign as a convergent series. Yes, correct. Kshitij, you have identified it correctly. It's an infinite GP. Okay. But that comes under convergent series. Okay. So the main reason why we are doing it, I mean, I don't want to go into details of that because it's again a concept which is going to be, you know, taught in, you know, higher versions of maths. It is for your information that you should know that such series which goes to infinity can be convergent only when the mod x satisfies this criteria, else it will be not. Is there any criteria for the first one? Is there any criteria for the when there are finite terms? The answer is no. There x can be anything, 100, 500, 1 lakh, 1 crore, whatever you want to put, you can put. It still will have finite number of terms only and hence finite value only. Okay. Now, at this stage, I would like to take a small break. Because it's already 6:15, okay. Rest of the expansions, that is slightly heavier ones, okay, I'll take it after the break, okay, so that we can have a fruitful discussion. Else what will happen?
you know, our stomach will keep grumbling and we would like to take a break, and you know, the discussion will not be very fruitful. So let me write down here, break. Let's take a break here. Okay. What time should we resume? How did we obtain this expansion? Don't ask me, Oshik, right now. You will not understand this right now. It is basically coming from principle of mathematical induction. Okay, there are a lot of ways to prove it. As of now, there are a lot of things. Thanks, Oshik, that you brought forth this thing that how do we get these expansions? What is the basis for these expansions? See, we are not going into the depth of the reasons for these expansions because right now they are beyond your scope. As I told you, some of the concepts which I am going to take up after the break, they fall under undergraduate syllabus prescribed by AICTE, All India Council for Technical Education. We'll take that up with a pinch of salt without going into their derivation. Okay. See, we have to be like the Zeno's paradox. That's an example of convergent kind of series. So we will talk about these series without proving them. Unfortunately, I hate doing that, Oshik, trust me. I don't want to, you know, give you something without proving it, but you will not understand it right now. Okay, let the right time come. When you are aware of a lot of tools, you will be able to understand these expansions. So as of now, with a pinch of salt and pepper, let's take it and let's apply it. Is that fine? Okay, let's have a break. We'll resume at 6:30. 6:30, milte, right? So let's resume at. Resume at 6:30. All right, so I'm assuming you people are back. Is everybody back from the break? Okay. So continuing with this list of expansions, there are expansions which we need to know, again with a pinch of salt, because we are not going to prove them as of now. It's beyond our scope right now to prove it. Okay. So these are expansions of the following functions which we are going to come across a lot while dealing with you know, calculus. So let's talk about them. Okay. So a to the power x expansion, okay, where a is basically a number greater than 0. This goes like this: 1 plus x ln a. Ln means log to the base of e. We have already discussed log before. X ln a square by 2 factorial. X ln a whole cube by 3 factorial. And it goes on and on for infinity. Okay. Now, how does this series come? Where does this series come from? What is the series called? Okay. A lot of questions will be arising in your mind as of now, but you have to be patient for some days, some, you know, period of time before we come to know about it. I'll just give you a few leads so that you can, you know, after the class ends, you can go and check it out on the net and study more about it. This basically is called the Maclaurin series. In fact, whatever series I'm going to write down, they're all derived from a series which we call as the Maclaurin series. Okay. Now, from where does Maclaurin series come? It comes from Taylor series. Okay. Now, how does Taylor series come? Again, it comes from the concept of, you know, expressing a function in terms of its derivatives. Okay. So I'll write it down for you. But this is something which is beyond your scope right now. So let's not waste too much time talking about it. Now I'm writing something called f dash, f double dash. What is f dash, f double dash? Does anybody know it? Some of you will be knowing it. F prime, what we call it. Yes, it is called the derivative. When I say one dash means first derivative at zero. Double dash means second derivative at zero. Okay, and so on. So as of now, we don't know derivative also. So there's no point, you know, it's a futile effort to discuss them right now. But all these series that you're going to come across in this particular list, which I'm going to give you, they have come from this particular, you know, series, which we call as the Maclaurin series. What do we call them? The Maclaurin series. Okay.
If you are interested to learn more about it, I can suggest a video from 3 Blue 1 Brown. Okay, just type Taylor series on YouTube and just see the video by 3 Blue 1 Brown. 3 Blue 1 Brown. Okay, just for your pictorial understanding of what is this theory is all about. But trust me, you will not require the derivation. You'll only require these results which come out from here. So as an engineer, you should be a good applicant of the concept. Okay, so we are not scientists, we are not studying pure maths, we are studying engineering maths. Okay, so there are two types of maths that we come across. One is engineering maths, other is pure maths. Pure maths is all about proving, that is what is called as rigorous proving of concepts. But we are studying engineering maths. Okay, unfortunately CBSE and all the boards, we follow engineering maths and we don't go into too much of how these formulas have come about. We go by their application, but it doesn't mean that you should not know where does the formula come from. In this case, I am not going to tell you because it is clearly going to be out of context. Okay, some of you will not understand anything. Most of you will not understand anything. Okay. Now, continuing with this, this is number one. The next one is a special case of the number one where A has been replaced by E. Remember E? 2.718 dot 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 dot. Irrational number. So that is 1 plus x square by 2 factorial. It's just that these terms, ln A, they all will start becoming a 1. So the first series will reduce to this. This is a very important series. I have personally seen a lot of applications of this series while problem solving. Okay. Now people ask me, sir, do we need to memorize this series? The answer is yes. Yeah, we can use it to prove the Euler's identity also, right? So remember, these series are all infinite series. Okay, they have all evolved from this formula, but unfortunately we have not introduced ourselves to derivatives officially, so I can't even verify them for you because you don't know how to find derivatives. But all these series that I'm going to write, they have come from this Maclaurin series. Okay, so if you follow this, you'll start getting all these expansions. Okay, so wait for the time, right time to come. The next series that you need to know is ln of 1 plus x. Ln means log to the base e of 1 plus x. The series goes like x minus x square by 2 plus x cube by 3. Note here, for change, there is no factorial in the denominator. Okay, so as the previous two series had, there were factorials, but there is no factorial in this particular expression. Okay. Next is, acha, this series works only for your x lying between minus 1 to 1. Now people ask me, sir, why does it work only for this particular interval? Why doesn't it work for other values? Now remember, I talked about something which makes the series convergent. If you go for higher values of x, higher than 1, or lesser than minus 1, then this series will start becoming divergent. So right hand side will become divergent, left hand side will be convergent. So there will be a mismatch. There will be a mismatch. That's why there is something which we call as the radius of convergence. Now see what it is. Let me explain you in plain and simple words. What is this expansion? See, this expansion is basically an effort from mathematicians to mimic a transcendental function by a polynomial. Are you getting my point? You're trying to mimic e to the power x by use of this function. Mimic means, you understand, mimic means it is trying to behave as, but not exactly the same function. And the fact that it goes to infinite term is that it can never accurately mimic something. See, for example, let's say even if I make a robot which will behave like a human being, okay, you can understand it's a robot. You can make out that no, this is not a human being, it is a robot,
right? Because its movement will not be as analogous movement like we do. It will, its movement will be all digital, correct? Right? So let's say if I'm turning my neck like this, okay? And if the same thing a robot will do, he'll do it like this. Okay, so I'm literally dancing in front of you. But the movement will not be as smooth and continuous like we humans can do. In the same way, think like e to the power x is like a human being. And the right hand side expression is like a robot. So that robot is trying to mimic that human being. But trust me, it will never be able to exactly behave like it because of some loopholes. So we say that in the field of science, in the field of engineering, I come from a circuit background. We normally used to feed some signals to the machines, okay, to make the machines behave in a certain way. So if I have to make a signal, I cannot generate that signal in a pure form. Pure form of a signal is very difficult to generate. So we used to mimic that signal through lot of, you know, superimpositions of different signals. Okay. So that will be almost trying to behave like that, but not exactly the same thing. Right? I'll show you an example. Let's say ln 1 plus x. Let me go to the GeoGebra. Okay. All of you see here. I'm first going to plot y is equal to ln of 1 plus x. Okay, this graph everybody knows, right? Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to plot the right side function. See, hope you have written this down. Everybody please copy this. X minus x square by 2, x cube by 3, minus x4 by 4, like that. Okay, please copy this. Done? Copied? Copied everyone? Okay. Now let me type this down on this. X minus x square by 2. Okay. See this curve, this parabola, you can see this part. Do you see this part where I'm moving my hand? It has almost traced that part. So it is mimicking like it. So there is no difference between ln 1 plus x and this whatever I have typed so far. In that zone, human eye cannot make out the difference. They think, oh, both are same thing in that zone, right? Isn't it? Let me further add terms. Plus x cube by 3. See, even though the arms have gone other way, that part, that's the smooth part you see, it will be exactly mimicking it. This part you see. It is so seamless with it. It is so, it has basically adapted to that function so well that there is no difference in that two functions. If you add further more terms, let's say minus x to the power 4 by 4. Okay. You realize that if you keep adding more, let's say you have gone till infinite more terms, you would realize that ln 1 plus x, and whatever you have written for that infinite terms, there would be no difference. There will be at least no noticeable difference between them, between minus 1 to 1. It will exactly copy that. Are you getting my point? So think as if this is a original currency and this is a fake currency. So you're trying to copy that fake currency by use of other things, right? Don't do that, huh? It's illegal. Okay. Right. That's why after so much of effort also, we cannot, replicate the work of God. Right. Sir is becoming philosophical, huh? You must be thinking. Sir, bhavnaon mein beh gaye hain. Okay. For sin x also, there is an expansion. Okay. So please note that. Sir, is there one, which... See, again, it is like that binomial thingy. 1 plus x to the power n and that series will mimic each other. See, again, Shitesh, what happens is you cannot exactly mimic it. especially when your, you know, right hand side term becomes divergent. You cannot exactly mimic it. That's why your series, both the terms cannot be equated for certain values of x. In fact, I should say in this way, both the series can be equated to each other only for a limited value of x. That is what we call as the radians of convergence, where both of the series will give you the same results, almost the same results. Okay. Yeah, this is very important. You'll use this very heavily. Sine x expansion. It's x minus x cube by 3 factorial plus x to the power 5 by 5 factorial minus x to the power 7 by 7 factorial plus x to the power 9 by 9 factorial. Okay, Okay, so there's an alternating plus minus sign. Okay, please note this works only when x is in radians. X is in radians. Okay, and this also has a radians of convergence. It will work only when your x lies between minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. Okay, beyond that, what will happen? It may become divergent. Okay. Cos x is 1 minus x square by 2 factorial. Unfortunately, dear students, you need to memorize this result. Sorry for saying so, but there's no other way out. Okay. The actual proof of this you learn probably 2 years from now, once you are in some engineering college or not. Okay. Or you see that video of yours, that 3 blue 1 brown. Okay. This also works when x is in radians. Okay. This also works when x is in radians. For a tan x expansion, it is in tan x expansion, there is no solid pattern. So you have to, many a times people will forget this particular series. So it's x plus x cubed by 3 plus 2 by 15 x to the power 5. Then the next term is 17 by 315 x to the power 7. Okay, you won't go beyond the first three terms, but if you want to know more, I can just give you. Okay, this will also have a radius of convergence. Your mod x should be less than pi by 2. Okay, don't worry much about the radius of convergence, because wherever you will be using it, the problem will be much within your radius of convergence. Okay. Now, apart from this, there are many other expansions. Okay, there is expansion for sine inverse x, cos inverse x, sine hyperbolic x, radians. So yeah, most of you are not aware of radians. Okay, as of now, ignore this. I'll be taking that up in trigonometry. Radians is basically a unit of angle, just like degrees. There is something called radians. Okay, just to tell you a simple figure, 1 radian. Is approximately 57 degrees. Approximately. Okay. In fact, we say pi radians is 180 degrees. So you can convert. So 1 radian will be 180 degree by pi. So roughly will come out to be 57 point something. Okay. So when I say pi radians, it means 180 degrees. When I say pi by 2, it means 90 degrees and all. Okay. Don't worry. There are so many things which we have to learn. We have just started it. Radius of convergence. Radius of convergence is basically that area where your right hand side of the expression is a convergent series. So what is the leeway that you can give to x such that the right hand side will still be a converging expression? That is called radius of convergence. Is that fine, Pradyun? Is that clear? Okay, so please remember this. If you have noted it down somewhere, very good. Okay, keep staring at it. Put it in front of your study table or something. Okay, now why are we using this? Because it will help us to solve certain standard limits. It helps us to understand certain standard limits. So now quickly in the next 45 minutes of your class, I'm going to introduce you to certain standard limits. Yes, all infinite GPs will work from minus 1 to 1. Not only 0 to 1, minus 1 to 1. Exclusive of minus 1 and minus 1. So the first of that standard limit that we are going to talk about is your algebraic limit. Now, all of you please listen to this because this is directly going to come for your school exams. Under algebraic limit, there is a standard formula which I am going to give you. Any limit which you see is of this type. Okay, I'll read it out for you. X to the power n minus a to the power n, where a and n are some constants. X is a variable here. As x tends to a, this entire thing will give you the answer as n a to the power n minus 1. Okay, so this is a ready-made result. Please remember it. But this time I'll prove it also for you. Now, all of you, please pay attention with the proof, because the proof is going to help you understand so many other things. So please pay attention, everybody. Huh? Now, look at this. X tending to A. Can I say X tending to A, I can write it as X as A plus H and H tending to 0. Again, I'm going to repeat it because the net was fluctuating. See, when you say X tending to A, it has the same impact as saying X is equal to A plus H and H tending to 0. Do you agree with me on that or not? Now you can ask me, sir, why not X tending to A minus H, H tending to 0? Both are fine. Nothing will go wrong even if you apply that. Okay, no problem, no doubt with this. Okay, if you are fine with this, then you must be also fine with me converting this entire limit. Let me convert this left hand side limit as replacing X with A plus H. And instead of saying A X tending to A, H is tending to 0. Yeah, why H is tending to 0, right? Or see, if H doesn't tend to 0, how would X tend to, how, see, if H becomes very, very small, very, very, you know, tiny quantity, won't X start becoming very close to A? And hence you will achieve X tending to A, right? Right? Okay. Now, by this time, you would have got my intentions. My intention is to use what? Binomial expansion. Yes, so I'm not going to use binomial expansion, especially on this guy that you see here. I'm going to use binomial expansion on that. How? Let me show you. So A plus H to the power N, okay, I'm going to write it like this. See, A 1 plus H by A to the power of N. Now many people ask me, sir, why did you write it like this? Why did you write it like this? You could have directly applied the expansion. See, right now I have told you the expansion where one of the number was 1 and the other was X. Correct? Second thing, I don't know N, my dear. N may be whole number. N may be not a whole number. Correct? Right? But irrespective of whether N is a whole number or not a whole number, I have at least ensured one thing, is that my X over here is always having a modulus less than 1. Now don't ask me how. H is tending to 0, no? 0 by a finite quantity will be almost tending to 0. So it will be less than 1 for sure. Correct. So I can apply the expansion whether to infinite terms or whether to finite terms, which I don't know actually, because N is not known to me, no? So I'm safe. I'm playing safe. I'm playing basically, you know, I'm putting immunity for myself against any type of N that is given to me, whether it is infinite terms or whether it is finite terms. Okay. So now I can bindas, befikr, without any chinta and fikr, I can apply my binomial expansion on this like this. n x n n minus 1 by 2 factorial h square by a square n n minus 1 and minus 2 by x 3 factorial into, let me drag it a little bit left, h cube dot dot dot. Now dot 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 doesn't mean I'm going to infinity. Dot 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 just means I don't know whether it's going to stop somewhere or it's going to continue up till infinity. Okay. Is everybody convinced with this step of mine? If no, please raise an objection right now. Okay, no doubt anybody, everybody's happy with my conversion. Okay, now see what I'm going to do. I purposely left a gap over here because I wanted to introduce the terms a to the power n. So let me subtract a to the power n here also. Okay. And you can see I have almost achieved the numerator. Denominator is just an h. So what I'm going to do, I'm dividing it by h. So this also I'll divide by h. Let me choose a stick for that. Okay, so far so good. So now limit of this as h tends to 0. So I'll write here also limit h tending to 0. Now the moment I put h tending to 0, in my mind what is running on? What is running on in my mind? That somehow I have to eliminate h from both numerator and denominator, what may come. Okay, because that is that problem creating factor for me. This h is that, you know, 0, 0 wala factor for me. Okay, now I can very well do that. If you expand the numerator once again, let me show you the expansion. A to the power n multiply back to all the terms. So it will become n h a to the power n minus 1. Then you'll have n minus 1 by, let me write 2 factorial as 2, no problem. Okay, let me write factorial only, no problem. Then h square a to the power n minus 2. Okay, dot dot dot. I don't need to write all those terms. Okay. No, if you want, I will write it. Else later on you'll ask, sir, what happened to those terms. So let me write it down. So it will be h cube a to the power n minus 3. Okay, dot dot dot. Minus this a to the power n. So let me write it in yellow so that you can identify that. Okay, whole divided by h. Okay, let me cancel off this a to the power n, this a to the power n. Okay, a to the power n will get cancelled. Okay, now you would realize, my dear students, that all these terms that are left off, they will have at least one h in them, isn't it? So take one h out from everybody. Take one h out from everybody which is left. And if you cancel it off with the denominator, okay, I'm just changing the powers here, right? So from 2, it will become 1. From 3, it will become a 2, like that. Okay, please note, whatever are the dotted terms, they will still have higher powers of h in them. For example, the next term after this will have an h cube in it. The next term after that will have h4 in it, like that. But at least I have cancelled out one h from the numerator and denominator. Okay. When I do that, it gives me a big sigh of relief, because now I can substitute my h as 0. I can substitute my h as 0. And when you do that, okay, you would realize that all these terms, this becomes 0, this becomes 0, all these dotted ones will start becoming 0, leaving aside, or the only one term that will survive is n a to the power n minus 1. And this is what is the answer which I gave you. Okay. So if you know this result, you can bypass all these things. That's why I gave that as a standard result. So you can easily use it, you know, in your questions to solve. Okay, so please remember this. Okay, prove, I'm sure you have understood it. Should I drag it up or down? You want to copy something? Don't waste time copying it. Anyways, the notes will be shared with you on the group. Just ask questions to me.
If you have any questions, please ask. Yes, Shitish, please ask. No. See, again, proof is a the way I proved it is basically a part of your learning of binomial theorem, which anyways you have to study. So you don't require it unless until you are a PU student. Shitish, you can ask me your questions. Yeah. We can expand it like this. Definitely, yes. Definitely, you can expand it like that. Okay, probably that is something which we teach in Olympiads, RMO, PRMO, and all. Yeah, you can definitely apply it like that. Okay, let's take some questions on this. This is a question which is picked up from your assignments which I have given you. This is question number 4. Okay, let me check whether I have this question with me. Just give me a second. I just pull out this question. Yeah, this question. This is the 4th question from your assignment. Okay. Now, here, let me tell you first something from our retrospect. Let's come from our, you know, previous learnings. That's called retrospecting. We cannot solve this by substitution because it is 0 by 0 form. Okay, it's discontinuous at A. We cannot solve it by factorization, right? We cannot solve it by factorization because it is not a polynomial. If you go for rationalization, it will be like OMG, oh my God, right? Because power 2 by 7 and all, my God, who will rationalize it? Correct. So you can see that the 4th method is what is basically your standard algebraic limit, which is going to bail you out from this. And if you know that, you can solve this question within a blink of an eye. Within a blink of an eye. So basically all you need to know is what is your n. A is already A. So your answer is 2 by 7 a to the power 2 by 7 minus 1. And you're done with this problem. This is your answer. Right? So this is the benefit of knowing this particular standard algebraic limit. It makes your life easy. Yes or no? Let's say if you had not known this method, what would you have done? No clue, that's what. Right? We would have been clueless how to solve these questions, isn't it? Okay. Let me take one more. From your assignment list only. Okay, let's take a few of these. Okay, let's not solve everything. We'll just solve the 4 of these. What a bad joke. No? Let's not solve everything. Only 4 of these we'll solve. Okay, first one. I want the answer within 30 seconds, guys. This is not worth a 30 second each. 30 seconds also is too much for it. Okay. First one. Tell me the answer. 128, let me tell you, is 2 to the power 7. Tell me the answer first. Of course, you can do it by factorization, but God bless you if you do it by that method. Okay. Yeah. So answer is n a to the power n minus 1. So it's 7 into 2 to the power 6. Whatever it is, I don't want to calculate it. Okay. So Shitish is saying it's 448. Fine. Is it fine? See, within 30 seconds, what? Within 10 seconds, I can do it. Second one, fast. I'm waiting for you to give me the answer. Fast. 3 into 1 to the power 3 minus 1. That's 3 only. 3 only, right? Right? How 1? Shitish made a mistake. Okay. Next one. Third one. Limit extending to minus 1. Now see, you can write it like this. X cube minus minus 1 cube by x minus minus 1. Now your A is your minus 1. N is 3. Yeah, what is the answer then?
Fast. 3 a to the power n minus 1. Again a 3. So we got saved. Yeah. Fourth one. Okay. X root x means x to the power 3 by 2. Okay. Yeah. Tell me the result. Fast. 3 by 2 a to the power half. 3 by 2 a to the power half. Okay. Any questions here? Any questions so far? Yes, you know the formula. You can do it like this. But your expression of the limit should match with your standard limit. Okay. Later on, I'll go in more depth of these formulas. Right now, for bridge course, we don't have to dig too much deep into that. Okay. Let's do let's do this question. This is again from your assignment. Third question. How will you do this? Let me give you a minute. Okay, now here you have to use some interim substitutions. Oh, sure, Priyam, I'll show you the previous slide. Meanwhile, all of you have copied this. Yeah, any questions here, Priyam? Done? Let me know once you're done. Shitij, your answer cannot be in terms of x. If your limit is applied to x, your answer will not be in terms of x. Okay, thanks, Priyam. Okay, let me take that up. It is slightly an advanced version of what you have learned now. See, here you have to use interim substitutions. You have to use interim substitutions. What is this interim substitutions? Some substitution before you get your answer. See, what I'll do is I will take 1 plus x square as y. Okay, I'll assume that to be another variable y. Okay, now you tell me, as x tends to 0, y will tend to, just answer this, as x tends to 0, y will tend to 1. Absolutely, Shitij. So can I write this entire thing, correct me if I'm wrong, limit y tending to 1, y cube minus 1 by y minus 1? Am I right? Correct? Now, this one, I could write it as 1 cube. Now, what have I done? I have basically made it resemble, it resembles this limit that we had just now done. Okay. Whose answer is very well known to us. A n to the power n minus 1. Okay. Now don't worry about the variables. Here your variable is y. Don't worry. There is nothing in the name. Okay. Literally there is nothing in the name. Right. I may call myself Superman. But if I don't have the characteristic of a Superman, I'm puss. Right. So whether you call x, y, if the expression follows that nature, it is going to behave in the same way. Variables are, after all, variables. Okay. So here, who is playing the role of n? 3. Who is playing the role of a? 1. So the answer is 3 into 1 to the power n minus 1. That is 3 itself. That is your answer for this question. The answer is 3. Done and dusted. You don't have to substitute anything back. No. Everything is taken care of. Okay. This is called interim substitution method. Okay, most of the question that you will be solving when I'm doing this chapter in the regular class will be those interim substitution methods. Is that fine? Okay. Now, let me introduce you to certain rules of limits. Before I go to other standard limits, there are 3 more left, which is trigonometric, exponential and logarithmic. But I thought I would talk about rules of limits with you.
I will not take much time. It will just take me 5 minutes to cover that up. So I should be able to, if you all cooperate, I should be able to finish off my limits concept in this class and start with derivatives in the next class. Okay. That's the class on 8th of May, I think. Yeah. See, limits follow these rules. Now, what are these rules? This is like let's say you have known how to evaluate your limits, but there are certain rules under which you need to work. Just to relate it to some analogous example, you know how to ride a bike, but then you have to follow traffic rules, you know, while you are riding the bike. Okay. So the rules are, if you're evaluating the limit of a function which has been multiplied to c being some constant, you can always pull the c out and just multiply it with the limit. Okay. So c has no role, as to say, you can pull out the c out and multiply it to the limit itself. If you are evaluating the limit of sum or difference of two or more functions, so as of now I'm just showing you two functions, but even if there are more than two, it'll work. It is as good as adding or subtracting the sum or the difference of their limits. Okay. If you have two functions multiplied or more than two functions multiplied, for sake of convenience, I'm just giving you two example, but it can be applied to any number of functions multiplied. The rule says it is as good as multiplying their respective limits. So this multiplied with this and so on. Okay, so if there are more functions, this is all multiplied to more terms. Here is a catch. Provided it is not an indeterminate form. It's provided these limits are limits, or you can say provided these limits provided it does not lead to an indeterminate form. Now, why do I say so? See, I'll give you an example. When I tell this rule to students, there are some students who start misusing it. So as to say, see, let's say I talk about that question, x square minus 1 by x minus 1, isn't it? So a student will say, sir, from this rule, what I'll do is, I will break this up as this into 1 by x minus 1, okay? And I will evaluate them separately. Okay, like this. Correct. And now this becomes zero. And I don't care whatever comes over here. Zero into something is zero. Okay. This is absolute blunder. Now you tell me, where is the blunder? Where did the student go wrong? He's following this rule only, right? Where did he go wrong? He said this is zero and he doesn't care whatever comes. Zero into anything is zero. Right, Shitej. See, actually, what he did led to something called zero into infinity form. So this quantity is not exactly zero. It's tending to zero to infinity form. It's another indeterminate form. Okay? So if your expression leads to another indeterminate form, it doesn't mean you have solved it. Correct? Let's say you go to a doctor saying that, doctor, I've got dengue. Okay, doctor say, okay, I'll cure it. I'll convert it to malaria. Will you say, yo, what doctor is he? He's converting dengue to malaria and saying, I've cured your dengue. So if it is an indeterminate form and you're converting it to another indeterminate form, it doesn't mean your problem is solved. Okay. This is only when it gives you some finite terms. For example, one of them gives you two, the other gives you five, then 2 into 5, 10 is your answer. Okay, that is fine. But not when it converts to another indeterminate form. Okay, let's take the next one. Even for the division, the same rule applies. Okay, so you can individually take the limit of the numerator and divide it by the limit of the denominator. Again, provided the same thing, my dear. I'm not writing it, I'm just putting ditto. Okay. It should not give you another 0 by 0. It should not give you another infinity by infinity like that. Okay. it works, this rule works even for one function raised to the power of another function. Okay, so this will be limit of this function raised to the power of limit of this function. Okay, now there are more rules, but I will tell you once you are aware of this. Again, remember, it should not lead to another indeterminate form. That means it should not become, zero to the power zero or, infinity to the power zero like that. In that case, these rules will all take a backseat. It will not work. Is that fine? Now, one algebraic limit I covered. So there is another standard limit which is called the trigonometric limit. Normally, I just introduce this concept in the bridge course. I don't go into details of it because I'm assuming many of you are not aware of trigonometric identities. So the biggest prerequisite for it is knowing your... Anything you wanted to copy here? Sorry. Let me know once you're done, okay? Zero to the power infinity is zero. Yeah. That itself is not an indeterminate form. So you will not need to come to this stage also, okay? You don't have to evaluate the limit. You can directly say it's zero. Finish it off there. Okay, so Auro is done. So let me take you to the standard trigonometric limits. Yeah, so here the greatest prerequisite is you should be aware of your TRIs. What is TRI? Trigonometric ratios and identities. So this chapter is not done for you yet. In the bridge course, I don't intend to do that chapter because that's probably the first or the second chapter which I'm going to start with. Okay, but still for your knowledge, I'm going to give you certain list of trigonometric limits which you should know because it will help you not only in maths but also in physics to a certain extent. Limit extending to zero, sine x by x is 1. Basically, I'm trying to say that sine x is approximately x when x is very small. This is something which you'll be using in simple harmonic motion in physics. Okay, now again it's a 0 by 0 form, right? So how do we get this result? Very simple. Let us use the expansions of sine x. Remember sine x expansion? I'm sure most of you won't remember it. It will take some time for you to keep these formulas in your mind. Okay, now if you divide by x, means you're dividing this by x. Okay, let's take the limit of x tending to 0. Okay, let's take the limit of this x tending to 0. So you can see that your term will become 1 minus x square by 3 factorial, x 4 by 4, 5 factorial, like that. And as x tends to 0, what will happen? All these guys will go for a toss, go for a 0. And you'll be left with a 1. So this 1 will be left out. That's why this result comes. Okay. When I'm doing this chapter for you, I'll prove this result by a method which we call as the sandwich theorem. I will use sandwich theorem to prove it. Okay. If you want, you can give a quick reading to it. Sandwich theorem, what is sandwich theorem and all. Nowadays, everything is available on YouTube. Just type sandwich theorem and millions of results you'll get for that. Next one, which we need to remember, is in the same way tan x by x tending to 0 will be 1. Please note here that x should be in radians. X is in radians. Now, I know a question will come in your mind. Sir, how does it matter? My x is tending to 0, right? Whether it's a radian 0 and whether it's a degree 0, it should not matter to me. It matters. I'll tell you the result when you deal in degrees. Okay. Again, what is the proof? What is the proof? I'm not going to do this. I'm just going to give you a hint. Use tan x expansion. Which expansion? Maclaurin series. Use tan x expansion for Maclaurin series. Okay. You will definitely get the answer. Oh, don't say that, Kshitij. It's a blessing. Yeah, you don't know the use. It's very, very good expansion. Okay. One thing else, one thing more that you need to remember. This is a very heavily used expression. Okay, in limits. 1 minus cos x by x square. Okay. This is half. Again, prove this by expansion. This you'll do now only. Now. One minus cos x by x square as x tends to zero is half. Prove it right now by using the expansion of cos x. I'm giving you 1 minute, and once you're done, please write done so that I know you are done. If you're not able to get it, write down that also, not able to do it. In your assignment, please do not try to attempt, if you are attempting, that's fine, but don't attempt the trigonometric part because I'll be dealing with identities first with you, then only you should be able to attempt it. But if you feel you are able to, you'll be able to manage it with expansions, then go for it. I'm not stopping you. So, could you repeat how you got one for the first one? See, a simple Oshik, what I did was sin x expansion already I've given to you in the list. Just check out the list. I don't want to go and search for the board, but I'm sure you would have written this guy. Okay. Divided by x. So when you divide by x, what happens? There's an x present in all the terms in the top, right? So all of these terms will lose out 1, 1x. So this guy will become a 1. Okay, this guy will become x square by 3 factorial. This guy will become x4 by 5 factorial and so on. Now when you substitute limit x tending to 0, leaving this 1 aside, everything else will become 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 h. Okay, Oro is getting 0 for this. Why Oro? Let's check. Cos x expansion is what? 1 minus x square by 2 factorial. Plus x4 by 4 factorial minus x6 by 6 factorial. Don't have to write a lot of terms. I think just few terms are sufficient. If you open the brackets, you'll see that 1 and 1 will get cancelled off. So it'll become x square by 2 factorial minus x4 by 4 factorial plus x6 by 6 factorial dot 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 to infinity. Okay. Divided by x square. Now, since x is tending to 0, you need to get rid of this x square term from the numerator and denominator. And thankfully, all the terms in the numerator are higher than x square. So you can cancel x square easily. So you'll get 1 by 2 factorial, x square by 4 factorial, x4 by 6 factorial, and so on. And finally, when you take the limit x tending to 0, you'll realize all these terms start getting 0, 0, 0. Only this 1 by 2 factorial is left off, which is half. That's how you get that result. Okay. Fine. So this is the standard trigonometric limit. Now I'll also talk about some standard exponential limits. Under standard exponential limits, there is one limit that we need to know. Limit of a to the power x, of course, a should be greater than 0. A to the power x minus 1 by x. This limit is given by ln a. This limit is given by ln a. Now, what is the proof for this? Very simple. Expansions. Okay, so a to the power x, let's recall a to the power x expansion is 1 plus x ln a plus x ln a the whole square. Let me write it separately so that we can, you know, adjust with the terms. Dot, 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 right? Okay, so when you do this a to the power x minus 1, so you bring this 1 on this side. So I'm just removing this 1 now. Okay, divide by x, that means you divide by x here. Okay, take the limit as x tends to 0. Take the limit as x tends to 0. So what will happen? This x will cancel off with this x. It'll cancel off with one of the x's. And the next term will be like x square ln a whole cube by 3 factorial and so on. So it doesn't matter. Anyways, once you have cancelled it and you put x as 0, you'll realize that these terms will start getting 0, 0 each. Okay, leaving you only with the ln a part, which is your this term. Okay, so this result also you need to remember. All the standard limits result you need to remember, because they're going to make your life very, very easy, because they're going to form the smaller units of your bigger problem. Okay, so derivation is clear. Anybody has any question on this? Let me just pause here for a few seconds. If you have any questions, please shoot. Again, thanks to expansion. Thanks to expansion that we are able to get such answers. Okay. Now there is a cousin of this expansion, which is where your A is replaced with an E. Nevertheless, the answer is not going to change. It is still going to be ln E. Ln E is nothing but 1. So this is also a very, very important type of limits. As of now, I have just substituted A as E, but you can try proving it by expansions also. Try proving it by expansions also. Any questions? Yes, you can apply L'Hopital. You can apply other rules also. Okay, to prove it, you can apply the concept of, yes, L'Hopital and all. Without L'Hopital and without expansion. Without L'Hopital, without expansion. No, I think so it'll be... No, I don't think so there is any other method to do it. Do you know of any such method? I would love to know that. Yeah, I don't think so any other method will work here. Especially when you're dealing with transcendental functions, it leaves you with not much of an option. Okay. So coming to the last part of limits chapter, which is standard logarithmic limit. Standard logarithmic limit. Under standard logarithmic limits, there's only one type of limit that we are going to talk about, which is ln 1 plus x by x as x tends to 0. This is 1. Okay. Now, what is the proof for this? Proof for this is very simple. All we need to do is use your expansions of ln x, that is x minus x square by 2 plus x cube by 3. Minus x4 by 4 and so on. Okay. Now people ask me, sir, didn't this work only for x lying between minus 1 to 1? Yes, it does. And we are very much in that interval. So when you are close to 0, you are satisfying this radius of convergence criteria. So you are very much under the radius of convergence. So we can definitely use this particular formula or expansion to solve this problem. So let me just put this expansion in place of ln 1 plus x. So you can realize that more or less the approach is very static. You just have to use your Maclaurin series expansion, cancel out the problem creating factor. Okay, so more or less the approach is the same as we had done in the previous problem. And as x tends to 0, you would realize all these guys will go towards 0. Okay, leaving aside one as the answer. Leaving aside one as the answer, but don't expect, you know, questions to come of the similar nature in your board exams. Sorry, in your school exams, there will be, of course, you know, a lot of tweaking around this concept. Okay, in the last 2 minutes, I would like you to just ask a question from you. Just one simple question. Okay. Since you claim that you have, you know, understood limits, so before closing this chapter, I would just like to ask you this question. So you have 2 minutes to answer this. Just as a thing, like as a test to end this chapter. Limit extending to zero, 4x plus mod x whole divided by 3x minus 2 mod x. Yeah, those who want to leave, they can leave. This is just a question for, you know, people just to close the topic so that I'm also happy that the boys have understood it or the girls have understood it. Next class will be a hardcore derivative, 3.5 hour sessions. So do not miss that. That's going to be very, very crucial. Done, anybody? Okay, so I'm getting different answers. 5, 4 by 3, etc., etc., etc. Okay, guys, here comes your final blow. Whenever there is a mod term, no, always be cautious. Evaluate the limit left to it. Evaluate the limit right to it. Especially when the mod is at the point where the limit is tending to, or where the x is tending to. Okay, so when you are slightly left to zero, please remember, mod x behaves as minus x when x is less than 0, and it behaves as x when x is greater than or equal to 0. So when you are at 0 minus, it will becomes 4. This will become a minus x, and this will become minus of 2 minus x. So it actually becomes 3x by 5x, so 3 by 5. But when you're dealing with x tending to 0 plus, it becomes 5x by x, which is actually 5. So the answer is limit does not exist. Okay. Anyways, we didn't end on a very good note, but that's fine. That's fine. This is just trying, you know, you're now understanding the nitty gritties of things. So anything contains mod x, it does, no, not like that. Not like that. It depends upon where you're evaluating it. Okay. So here you're evaluating it at a point which was actually the critical point for that. Right. For example, let's say if I said the same question, x tending to 1. When you're evaluating it at x tending to 1, then Kshitij, what will happen? They will happily assume xx for mod. So it'll become just 5x by x. So there you don't have to worry about left to 1, right to 1, because 0.999 also it will be x. 1.001 it will also be x. So let's not make a general rule like this, that whenever there's a mod, a limit will not exist. Not like that. Yes, if the mod is having a critical point where the x is tending to, then probably it may not have a limit. Okay. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you. Good night. Namaste, Shabba Khair, stay safe. Bye-bye.